There we go. Okay. So, session number 4 of Disadvantaged, our 5th edition live streamed D&D game, starring Golden Icon as Gaikon, the Mountain Dwarf Barbarian, Jazzy Wazzy 94 as Clover, our little forest gnome druid, Go Broba Fett as Broix, the dragon, the brass dragonborn, right, brass?
Bronze.
Sorry. Doesn't matter. The bronze the bronze dragonborn bard. And of course, Gaddy playing our half elf rogue, Ruka.
Sorry, excuse me.
Jesus Christ. Really? In the middle of the introduction.
Good. Has to be my introduction too. Fuck me, right?
I know. So, guys, girls, lady. No. What happened on our last session?
Well, last session.
Jazzy with the pog save.
Oh, yeah.
You mean no Clover? Fucking Clover?
Oh. My bad. Oh, sorry.
Thank you. I need to be immersed.
Yeah. I rolled a nat 20 on persuasion for Voltar to come with us on the trap. Or I guess the trap we're setting up for him.
Basically telling Voltar to stop being a baby back bitch.
Yeah, I basically said, my father always said, if you wanted a job done, you better do it yourself. And then he was like, okay.
true, yeah. Why? What is this trap? What is this scheme, this plot that y'all are setting up right now?
Basically, we're gonna throw Voltar under the bus. And have him captured
by
the good guys, the assumed good guys.
The Jackal,
Inquisitor of the Sentinel Guard,
the cool motherfucker, the cool dude.
Yeah, he is cool.
There's always a cool guy, right?
Fucking man, it'd suck if he was a bad guy, you know what I'm saying?
Sephiroth to our soldier right now.
True. So, yeah, your original meeting with Voltar didn't go so well. Somebody left crying. I'm not going to point fingers or, you know.
She's very emotional.
Name any names. But a certain forest gnome, yeah, maybe, ended up leaving crying as she was chastised and yelled at by Voltar, this apparent member of the Eye, a somewhat evil organization, a thieves guild meets dark brotherhood group that tends to run some shady business. He was less than thrilled with your performance on the job he gave you down on the Silver Throne, the ambush of these grave robbers, these researchers, as you now know. And didn't go so high, and nothing of value was really brought back to him.
We tried.
And after he told you all you were getting for compensation was your lives, he had you leave, where you were approached by another shady figure. Who would have thought? A lot of those around here. He claims his name is Jackal, the Jackal, being an Inquisitor of the Sentinel Guard, which you all know to be the main force in Sartol, this capital city of the Heartlands here, the Sartolian.
It's pretty cool.
His whole job is that of seemingly rooting out those that are getting out of line, have a little more power than they probably need or deserve, and kind of keeping them in check. And as he does often with the Eye, he's on to another one. And you lot, having murdered a few guards, were not exactly in the best position to bargain with.
I claim self-defense.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
Well, we can go to trial and we can do a little D&D trial. It'll be great. And we'll get to see a dragonborn beheaded.
It's a full trial.
Yeah, so he asked you to help him capture Voltar. He didn't really seem to give too much of a fuck about Voltar's acquaintances, Sariandi and Daz, though he recommended they try to be put down. He does want Voltar alive. Anybody else think of anything else? Are we missing anything?
That the plan included a promised sum of, I think it was like 5K gold or something. I didn't write that down.
You didn't write that down?
I knew you did.
Hold on. I wrote it down.
You're back going through the VOD. 1 second.
And using a, it was using a forged letter that had the seal of the Sentinel Guard.
The seal of the Astari Conclave.
Conclave, yeah, the stamp of the Conclave, which looked like the Eye of Ra with the like number four on the side of it.
Yeah, it was kind of like more so the Eye of Oris is really it. But it's kind of the Eye of Oris with almost like a cross behind it and some flourishes on the side to almost give it a diamond-like appearance. And this stamp in the center of this turquoise teal wax sealed this letter, which mentioned that these researchers with this book, this tome, whatever they had that seemed to be of some value to Voltar was no longer being sent down the river on this barge, as he thought. Because, well, they'd been ambushed once there, they didn't want it to happen again. So they were taking a secret caravan, a few guards, and they were going to take the road from Ormskirk to Sartol, leading the east side out of town. In this letter, they mentioned that there was a stipend of gold, 1,000. Is, I believe, what you said. That's what I wrote down, at least.
That's what I have written down as well.
Cool. That sounds right.
A stipend of 1,000 gold for these researchers, for their troubles, and maybe to hurry them along with whatever this guard may be. Leaving at nightfall this night. It was early in the day. You all decided to take a nice long rest to prepare, gather your supplies, gather your spells, and make sure you were ready for the day's conflict. Anything else?
Please, Kabuli.
That was pretty spot on.
All right. Well, in that case, as you all head up to room number 3 with a rusty shit key that you were given, you all walk in because you only wanted one room. What are you doing? As you prepare for the night's mission.
Is there a drinking glass or anything in the room?
Oh, without a doubt. You can find a couple of small cups on a little plate in the corner.
Are we all heading inside?
How many beds are in this room?
2.
I'm gonna immediately hug everyone goodnight and then lay down and take my rest.
There's a small chair, like a little, like a somewhat cushioned, not well cushioned, some tears in it, but in the corner as well. So somebody could probably try to kick out in that.
Hey, Brorix, how about you go ahead and take the chair? I'm going to wedge my axe up against the door and lean against it.
Ah, no, that doesn't sound good to me. I'm going to walk over and like kind of step over this tiny ass chair and just kind of like scrunch down in it the best I can and just...
It creaks slightly as you like. Yeah.
You can see the legs starting to bow in.
The legs aren't bowing. It's more so that where they're attached is a little loose. So like leaning the wrong way at one time may just. You don't know. We'll see.
Okay.
Did I hear Brovok say that he's getting in the other bed, or is he sleeping in the chair?
Oh, he's getting in the chair. So you would have that.
I'm gonna say now, boy. If you wanna go sleep with me, I'll kneel. Go up against
You know, bro, usually I would take you up on the offer, but I think we need a shower before we do any of that.
Of course.
I'll go ahead and lay down the bed. Dagger, like, nightstand or under the pillow, whatever is safer.
The nightstand was, so there is a nightstand kind of like in between the two beds, but there's some definitely some space there. It's not like right up aside. So the pillow would probably be your
just
safest bed.
This is something that I do like in real life. Can I open the drawers? Can I investigate the drawers and the?
You snoop around the hotel room?
Always.
Good. Yeah, so you open it, you see your bot. No.
That old TV remote.
Exactly. So, honestly, nothing. It looks like some old food scraps in one. Definitely gone bad.
Hey, bro, I'll find you a snack.
All right, help, boy. I appreciate it.
I'm gonna examine it and see that it's like
old
shit and old. I'm gonna kind of flick it off.
I do as we're getting ready to rack out, I do want to take the glass and put it up against the adjacent wall and try to listen through the glass and see if I hear mumbles or any shuffling from the room next door.
So you actually hear no sound from the room next door, but you definitely hear some the sounds of just people having a drink down in the tavern below. There were a good number of people still in there, that 7 to 10, depending on, you know, creeping on the corners, you probably could eye everyone, but there was definitely a good number of people down there with Voltar, Daz, and Sariandi kind of tucked away in their corner table.
Question, in our room, what does the ceiling look like? Are there like rafters or like beam?
Yeah, so you have a singular beam and then some smaller runners.
How high up is it?
Oh, about 9 feet. No, sorry. This is an older place. It's a little lower, probably closer to 7.5 or 8. It's not very tall.
So judging by my character's height, I can touch it with my hands easy.
Yeah, without a doubt.
All right. I would like to attempt to climb up on top and rest in the beam.
So once I see that he does that, I'm going to grab the chair and pull it over. And right next to where my axe is wedged up at the handle of the door, I'm going to lean the chair back against the door as well and just get comfy in the chair.
Yeah, without a doubt. So, Broix, you kind of hand on hand on this beam and you start to you dig your claws in, you pull it. You hear that creaking a little bit as you begin pulling up some dust. It's real dust and grimy up there. And as you start pulling, you know, doing a pull-up and kicking your leg up a little bit, you look down and you hear, as Gaikon's dragging the chair out of the corner from where you were sitting. He sets it right up next to the door where his axe is propped under the handle leaning. And you see him kind of cozy up, hands under the beard as a dwarf do. And, almost immediately ready for a nap. It takes you the, you know, let's give me an acrobatics check or athletics. I'll let you pick.
Which one am I better? Definitely acrobatics. Plus 4. 12.
12? So yeah, you're easily able to pull yourself up there and kind of like a fucked up scaly cat, a lizard, if you will. You're kind of like hanging on this fuck. It's not very big. It's terribly uncomfortable, but you fucking did it.
I just want to kind of like basically Snoopy it.
Yeah, that's what you're doing up there. It's terribly uncomfortable. But you're up
can't
there.
Can't be any worse than the fucking chair, let's be honest here.
I mean, Icon looks comfy in that chair. I'm not going to lie.
Well, he's also probably like smaller than the chair. So like.
Hey, to you, big, you're there.
I'm big as shit, come on.
And that's a small beam. You're on a wooden beam up on a. You're fine. You're good.
I'm good.
As you all begin to fall into your deep, deep sleep, your midday nap, any of your spellcasters that can change your spells, I don't think you can, bro. But Clover, you can choose your spells however you see fit, getting ready for the night's event. Ruka, a knife tucked under his pillow, hand on it. Gaikon, an elbow resting next to his axe. Bro, hanging off the rafters. Sleep comes.
The tail's got to have a mind of its own. It's going to be the one watch taking
it's
guard.
It's just fucking swinging. The tail's going up there. Jesus.
As we start kind of resting, I will wait a bit to fall asleep because nobody took first watch or anything, and I don't know how long we're gonna be sleeping for. So I'm just gonna
stay awake. It was early in the morning. You have roughly 8 hours, which will give you a small amount of time, half an hour or so, before you need to be downstairs to meet Voltar. As he said, meet him down here just before nightfall.
Got it.
Okay, so you take your watch. Give me a perception check.
What he's really doing is snacking on the food that wasn't shared with anybody else.
Don't judge me, mate. 17.
Yeah, so almost the entire watch, you hear the rambunctious sounds of the early morning crowd in the tavern. Seems to have a fairly popular, or you know, night crew that seems to come in early in the morning, or so it would seem with the amount of people that were in there. And that continues your entire watch. You hear the occasional tune, feet stomping, laughing, some lulls in it, but no one comes to the door. No one tries to break in. Who are you waking up next?
I suppose Gaikon makes the most sense. I don't want to risk waking the lizard and having him fall on me.
I like that the only one who could reach him won't wake him. Perfect. Gaikon, you feel Ruka come up to you and...
I know you're trying to sleep, but it might be wise to listen for people walking towards our room. The only people who know we're here really is Voltar. So
yeah, but I got the axe wedged here.
I'm not worried about that. I'm more worried of listening ears. People watching us, right?
All right, we'll get some sleep.
As Ruka heads back to his bed for his midday nap. Icon. As you take a moment, you're sitting in your chair, you have your hand ready on the axe, just in case. You continue to hear the sounds downstairs. Give me a perception check.
13.
13? Yeah. So, mostly the same as Ruka, honestly. Not a lot of change. There's definitely people in the tavern. The wretch, if you will. Drinking, fun. Sounds like at one point somebody starts to head down the hall. You hear the floorboards creaking before a door somewhere else, before your room, is opened. You hear the door shut. And then kind of just the sounds of the tavern again as your 2 hours passes. Who would you like to wake up? Or if you'd like to do anything else, that is, as well.
Guess at this point, we'll go ahead and wake Clover up and see how she feels about taking watch.
For sure. You walk over to the other bed in the room. Clover curled up in a little fucking cloak ball.
Hey, Clover. Clover, wake up.
Is it time to go already?
Not yet. The rogue wanted us to do different watches tonight, so it's your turn.
He's always like that. Okay, go get some rest. I'll keep watch. I'm gonna stand up and sit on the floor and watch the door and listen.
All right. So Gaikon heads back to his chair. Axe still wedged under the door handle, keeping it safely shut. Hands back in the beer, just kicks it back, ready for a few more hours of shut-eye. Clover, as you sit down, can I get a perception check?
That is an 18.
Ooh, all right. So, as you're sitting on the floor, kind of twirling the much too big cloak that you wear, just kind of wasting the time. You hear the people downstairs, again, continuous from start to finish of your watch. And at one point, you do hear somebody coming up the stairs. Step, step, step. As they seem to be walking, fairly heavy-footed. They walk towards your room. You hear it getting louder and louder. It pauses. Quiet. No more than 10 seconds. You hear it start to walk away. Again, those heavy thudded footfalls. Moves back down the hall the way it came. A few moments later, silent. Nothing else is coming up the stairs. Nothing or up the, down the hallway. Just the regular sounds of the tavern.
Okay. I'm gonna just wait until my time's up and then try and wake up Robard.
Good luck.
All right. After another hour or so, your watch comes to an end. You have your staff, which on your tippy toes and holding the base of it, you're able to give him a good little tap, you know, a little crack.
I'm gonna swat at her staff with my tail and continue to snore. Crack a lightning, like.
I let go of my staff because I'm on my tippy toes and like have barely any grasp on it. So it falls to the ground and makes a loud noise.
Ruka, an eye open. Gaikon, I'm assuming sleeps through the staff falling. Yeah, I figured. Bro, you feel a tiny little hand hanging onto your tail at this point. It's almost like something's grabbing it, tugging on it.
What the fuck are you doing?
She's swinging.
As this goes on, take my tail and I'm gonna bring it up like to my eye level and just like peek up at what I'm wondering. And then how do you want that logo?
It's time for you to watch.
I'm just gonna stare at her, give out like a big sigh, then just kind of like gently like drop her down. And then I'm gonna scurry off the beam.
Yeah, so as you lower you, Clover, you feel your feet touch the ground again as as Broix, claws in hand, slides off, holding it, and then he sets his feet on the ground. Clover heads back to her little blanket ball. Her nest, exactly, on the bed. Brooks, you find a spot somewhere in the room, I would assume?
Just sitting.
All right, yeah, you hang out on the floor, kind of watching the door, listening. Can I get a perception?
I want to ready my crossbow.
Yeah, of course. So you sit down, crossbow on the lap, bolt cocked, hand on it, ready to go. Can you give me a perception check?
Stay strapped or get 11.
11. Fairly quiet. You do hear people downstairs. Sounds like they're having fun. They're drinking. The tavern. That's like your shit, but nobody's coming up the hall.
Just the sound of everyone having a good time drinking and whatnot. Just gonna, like smack my lips, like, you know, like a nice cold ale would seem good right now. Oh no!
And good it is. As the hour goes by, the second hour passes. You can kind of at this point feel it's probably getting late. Not quite nightfall, but you know it's probably getting close to time. You waking everybody? What you doing, bud?
Thank you. All right. I want to go ahead Who's the closest to me?
It'd probably be Gaikon in his chair, because the other two are in beds.
Alright, I'm gonna just kinda like lean up to him, kinda like pat him on like the chest and whatnot. Come on, get up now, little boy.
I'm gonna flail awake and send in the chair forward, crashing down back on all four of its legs.
As you kinda jump for a moment with a little kick, one leg goes as the whole chair starts to go, the other leg's kick as the whole chair hits the ground. Everyone else in the room is very aware and awake at this point.
That would have caused Ruka to shoot up.
Straight up, dagger out. Oh, yeah.
Clover's gonna slowly...
motion for Brorex to move the chair back while I get the axe out from under the door.
When Gaikon moves the axe, I want to check the outside of the door and see if there's anything on the door.
Okay, so he pulls the axe. You go for the door handle. Take a moment to touch it. And the door handle. As you slowly open the door... Nah, there's nothing there. It's just the hallway into the tavern.
Okay.
I don't like that smile.
I'm gonna also comment to everybody in the party that, man, this inn really needs some different music.
No, somber, spooky. Mm-mm.
Hey, but we've been listening to this song all night. I mean, we went to bed, I heard this song. When I was on watch, I heard this song. The song's still playing.
Maybe the people running this place are one trick pony. Are we ready?
Did Zvoltar say that we're meeting him?
Yes, here, downstairs.
Okay, well, let's head that way.
All right. As you head down the hall, wrap around the corner of the stairs, down into the actual tavern itself, you see a few other people around the room. Probably 7, 8 or so. And as you kind of look around in the corner, in his usual spot, a few mugs around Daz, the Orc. Sariandi standing kind of off to the side, leaning, watching as always. And Voltar sitting. As all of the four of you come down the stairs and wrap around. Eye contact. He nods to you, motions you over.
I'm gonna go ahead and walk over.
As you cross.
I'm going to motion to the barkeep to line us up some mead and bring him over as we head that direction.
Okay, yeah. So as everyone begins crossing the main open of the bar, you hold up a hand, a couple fingers up. Bartender, hey! As he gets a couple mugs poured as you pick them up and bring them over with him. Walking into the tavern, you do see out one of the windows at this point is getting close to nightfall. You probably have 45 minutes or so before the departure time for your setup. As you all close in, Gaikon, you have your ale.
Hey, you ready? We gotta start to move to get to this, the outskirts of town. It's a bit of a walk from town, 15 minutes or so.
Right.
And I want to make sure we get you out without any guards seeing you. But, as it so seems, we've had a stroke of luck. It seems you lot have left town.
So you learned that, did you?
Hey, of course I've learned that. Would have been helpful information at the start of this. But good on you. I don't know how
plausible
you did it.
Plausible deniability.
Well, there's not much denying you killed the guards already, so point's a little moot. But make us a little easier for us to travel from here to the east side of town. Few guards, it seems, went south looking for you. Y'all ready to go? Or shortly, at least? We don't have long.
I'm ready.
ready.
Oh, no, I'm ready to go now, no more.
Right.
Sure.
Smile and nod.
It'll be myself. Guys, as he holds his hand up to his large orc friend, Seriandi, and a few extra hired hands, because I don't like getting my hands dirty. But I'll make sure personally we get there. Now, please follow me. As he stands up. And as he stands up, there's a strange moment of almost panic from all of you. As in the tavern, the various people standing, you hear all a chair screech back all at once as six other men stand up in the tavern.
Phew, uh-huh. You say.
As he begins to walk back towards the that back hallway where you originally entered, the wretch. Daz, next to him, Seriandi kind of gives you a head nod for you to go. As the six other individuals, various human, a singular dwarf, a halfling, and it looks like a half-orc, and another cloaked hooded figure. They all kind of line up behind you guys, arms crossed, hands on various swords, maces, crossbows. Armed to the teeth, without a doubt, ready for a fight, if need be.
Voltar, did you pay for all these men?
Pay for them? They're my men.
So they're willingly volunteering for this endeavor.
Let's go. Voltar seems to just give you the shoulder as Daz next to him walks out. Behind you again, Seriandi tapping her foot as you all are expected to follow.
I'm gonna follow.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone going?
Yeah.
Okay.
If there's a presumed marching order, I would like to know where Daz is. I want to keep eyes on him and Seriandi if possible.
So you guys are kind of in between Daz and Seriandi. You have Voltar leading this expedition, this group, with Daz directly behind him, kind of on his side, almost like his shadow. And Seriandi then, after Daz, it would be you four, Seriandi directly behind you guys, kind of ushering you along, sticking with them. And then behind Seriandi, the large group of members of the Eye, if that's what they are, or Voltar's personal guard, hired men. As you all walk out the back of the alley, you're all in this back alley. You originally were led to the wretch by Seriandi. Quietly now, follow me. Don't stop for anything. We should be fine, though. We've been paid for. As he begins walking at a brisk pace through these back weaving alleys, you guys are following him with a decent pace at this point as you weaving left, right, straight, walking down an alley, going up a flight of stairs, straight, cutting through a house as he's leading you through these mazes of these small shacks and these little hovels and such of the poorer side of Ormskirk, leading east, though. It feels like it takes almost 10 minutes through this weaving path, which normally shouldn't be any problem for getting to, the edge of town, but it takes a little bit of time before you arrive. The house, you finally cut through one last house as the door opens into a fenced in area. He brings you to the edge of this kind of tall fence, slides open the gate. Well, time to depart Ormskirk. No issues. I've held up my side of the bargain so far. You ready to uphold yours?
Yeah, we'll get that artifact for you.
That's why we're here.
And the gold. Now.
Yeah.
I want you lot up front. At least until I know where we're going. It's a barn not far, right?
We were told the road headed east towards Sato. That there's a path. They were to be sticking to the road.
All right then.
Was a small stable or barn?
Hey, okay. Let's move. You lot can lead this. As you all file out of this little fenced-in area, this gate, you see the main road running just next to this house you were in that you cut through at the last second. You head left onto this path, and you see the road leading forward through the sparsely wooded edge of town. It takes maybe 10 minutes. It's a very well-traveled road, too. You know, there's very clear-cut. And as you spend a few minutes traveling, moving, it's very quiet and very tense.
As we reach a point of, like, traveling for a bit, I want to motion Gaikon to kind of walk up to me.
Hey.
And
what is it?
Quietly... ish, like trying not to be suspicious. Mm-hmm. I want to tell Gaikon, say, listen, I'm watching Voltar and the others. You need to guide us, all right? So just keep us on the path heading east and look for the overturned cart. That's where they're supposed to be, yeah?
All right, I can do that. So I'm going to reposition my axe and just turn while making sure I look at everybody else in the party and start heading down the road towards the cart.
Okay. Also, I want to get everyone's attention, just like kind of like nonchalantly. I just want to be like, you know, it didn't get a little hairy. And then I just want to give the motion of like.
What?
You know, don't.
I respond in thieves can't.
Okay, so Gaikon now leading the group. At this point, nightfall, dusk is here. It is dark, or getting dark, I should say. And as you begin leading this group, it's only 10 minutes, it seems, before up ahead of you, Gaikon, a couple hundred feet, you see the outline of what looks like some sort of large building. The flicker of torches kind of inside of it, and it looks like some outside of it as well.
Ooh. All right, so I think I'm going to kind of just do a scan of the area and make sure that there's not anybody lurking around the edge of the building or hiding around any obstacles that are around.
Okay, yeah. So give me a perception check.
16.
So as you kind of slow, and you're used to this low light, being a dwarf and having lived in this darkness before, you stop for a moment and you just focus. You see some torches moving. It seems like the torchlight seems to be moving inside the barn. Kind of flashing through some of the slats in the boards, the occasional window. There are a few torchlights, it seems, outside, but behind on the opposite side of a cart. In between the barn or stable and the road. So we have the road going straight to it, the cart just on the side of the road, a space with some lights outside, and then this large barn.
I'm going to turn around and motion for all the party members to pay attention and kind of give them like a silent, you know, pointing towards that direction. And as quietly as I can muster with my dwarven voice, let them know that I'm pretty sure we have company.
So up behind you, you feel a hand on your shoulder, Gaikon. You look over there. Voltar.
Well, all right, seems so far y'all are doing good, worth your money. So I'm keeping an eye on you lot. We're gonna head around the right side, I think.
and have my men go left. Come up behind this stable. Make sure. I'm assuming there'll be some guards. They'll take from one side. We'll take the other. If you can, leave one of them magic types alive. I'd like to question them about what they found. Any questions as he kind of looks to the rest of you?
Nah, don't take no questions from us. I'm gonna go on and do what we need to do. You know what I'm saying now?
If you don't mind, if I can stay in the back, one punch really hurts if they hit me.
You'll be up with the rest of us. I don't care if you're at the back of this group, but I better see your tiny little feet moving when mine are.
Oh, they will be.
Well, then. All right. Follow me. And you see him kind of take a stop for a minute before he goes, and he motions with his hand pointing towards the back side of the barn, the opposite side of the road that you are going to head on. So the group splits. You have Voltar, Daz, you four, and Sariandi kind of making sure Clover keeps up right behind her. To the left, the six cloaked and hooded individuals clad in dark leathers, daggers, swords, and one with a mace. They all begin moving through the trees to the left behind the barn. Can I get a stealth roll from all of you, please? If you would like to sneak. Voltar's and his crew is sneaking. And you see that as they all begin keeping quiet and low.
16.
Okay.
22.
Question, Betty. What is the, what kind of ground are we on? Like, just like grassy grass or
it's a little bit loose, kind of on the sides of the road. At least there are sparse trees and the occasional shrub bush, but it's definitely not thick woods. It's mostly open. There's just like a little outcrop of trees and such here and there, but mostly as you push off the road, it's that tall grass of the plains of the Heartlands. But as you head closer and closer farther away from Sartul, and towards east, northeast, it's more trees.
Would you say there's twig below that we have to watch out for?
Occasionally, yeah.
All right. Can I purposely step on a couple twigs for like an early alarm type stuff?
Ooh. Can you please?
But make it look convincing, like, oh, I'm sorry now, fuck it.
I'll let you pick performance or deception.
Oh, crap.
I rolled a dirty 20.
Definitely deception, because plus 7.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Fuck me. 16.
All right. So, as everyone stays low and begin moving extremely quietly, almost quieter than, Daz is. Sariandi's almost silent, it feels like, walking behind you guys. Clover, if you didn't know she was there, it'd be scary, honestly, the way she's moving through these trees and the ground here. And just as you all kind of wrap around this 100 or so foot gap, as you get within about 50, 40, and Broix, it's almost like daggers as Voltor stops, everyone turns, and is staring at you. You see him, a dagger in one hand and a short sword in the other, and he goes, and he just kind of holds the dagger up.
I just want to, like, kind of, like, almost, like, whisper to him, like, well, I'm a dragonborn, what the fuck you want me to do?
I'm just going to wave my hands and kind of try to get their attention and just...
Yep. As you see him kind of shake his head, go, again, you know, the quiet shh, shh to everyone again. As he waits just a moment, listening. And they begin wrapping around again. At this point, as you move around to the opposite side of the cart, having traversed the entire road almost, just the side of the road, you then see the silhouette of a person holding a torch, and then see maybe another person. It looks like it's kind of cut off, hidden behind the cart a little bit. As you all stop, traverse back, block, you know, using the cart to block yourself from these bodies,
As you begin moving forward, Voltor taking a step, quietly moving. As you get up almost within 20 feet of this cart, you see the torches inside. You hear some sounds inside. It sounds like people just walking and very quiet mumbling. But that's about it. As you guys are all moving closer and closer, you hear Voltor.
All right.
And this is, he's speaking very quietly, but for the sake of audio and video for people watching.
All right. Now, we're going to wrap around the cart and take them down. Unless one of them is one of these quiet types or magic users, whatever they are. The robed ones. I want some information about these artifacts and where the gold is.
You can leave them to me. I'll take care of it.
Sirion, you will help.
Baddie, looking at the barn itself, do I see, like, any sort of, like, lanterns or anything, like, on a ledge of some sort, like buckets or tools?
You can't see into the barn. The barn main two doors are almost all the way closed. There is a gap, and that's where you're seeing the light flickering out from them.
Okay.
As you moved around from the side, you saw the side of the barn, and there was like a lantern on one of the windowsills down the bar, the side of the barn. So about 20 or so feet away from you around the corner. Mm-hmm. But the front, there are no like big windows. You have a big top barn door that's closed. Mm-hmm. And then you have the main two sliding doors that are almost all the way shut with just a small, you know, 4-inch gap with light flickering, the occasional shadow moving by. So there's clearly people in there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Carry on.
Okay. As you take those last few steps getting up to the cart, see Voltor kind of pull out his daggers. You have Daz there, a massive hammer in hand. Sariandi, bow drawn. And as they start creeping around the cart, you can see the shadow now of one of these figures on the opposite side from the torchlight. Ah! You hear a scream from the other side. Master Darius, it's a trap! As you hear the voice cut out. You see, at this point, Voltar and Daz immediately to arms. They kick around the cart. He goes to stab one of the figures. As you all rush around, you see two dummies. Kind of straw stuff. Torch in hand. As he starts stabbing, and it takes a moment before he just looks and realizes what's going on. He turns to you. What is this?
I'm throwing a dagger at him.
Gotcha, bitch.
Let's roll initiative.
Okay.
Can I get a surprise attack?
I'm going to say no.
I got a 15.
17.
Right, hold on.
Okay. Hard.
Third.
Hobo, murder, hobo.
Well, I would say this doesn't fall under murder hobo. This is fairly all right.
Getty, to be fair, we don't know if it's good or bad. We were told something. We failed something, so we went with plan B. So
yeah, I hope plan B's not bad.
I also don't like these people.
I mean,
all right, starting with 25 to 20.
20.
God. 21.
Oh, shit, girls. All right, 21. Fuck yeah.
Initiative 3, yeah, 21.
Buy y'all's dice.
Give us some time. Batty will have some exclusive dice.
Holy shit. Now I'll talk about that. We're doing a giveaway at the break. I totally forgot. Fuck. Whoops.
We're doing one at the end as well.
There you go. One at the end as well.
The partner, by the
fuck off. Ruka, you had the 20, right?
Correct. Dirty, not natural, by the way.
Yeah. It's all right. 19 to 15.
15.
17, 15?
Yep.
And that's everybody, right?
Yes.
I just forgot your names. Holy shit. Clover, you had the 15?
Yes.
Bro at the 17. Ooh, I totally forgot your name. God damn.
Gary.
All right, then. So, as you all come around the cart on the right side of it, you have the cart to your left and the barn to your right now. You see one of these hooded figures come running around the corner, dagger in hand, coming straight for you, Ruka.
Mm-hmm. Of course he is.
Okay. As he's coming, rushing, dagger in hand, there's a moment whilst it... as you watch his sword pierce his chest. Very thin, long, as it's drawn out. And as he falls behind him with a flourish, you see Jackal. Long black hair, elven ears.
Fuck.
So cool.
He's so cool. No, it's me, Jackal.
You see him as he readies. He holds the blade up high, kind of in a fencing stance. Gaikon.
I want to look and see where, what's the dwarf dude's name? Damn it.
Voltar.
Voltar.
So it Voltar, is, yeah. So right now it is Ruka and you kind of towards the front, Gaikon. Voltar directly in front of you guys. I mean, you're all right there as you wrapped around that corner. You have Daz next to Voltar. Behind you, Broax, Clover, and Sariandi. All within, I'm going to say, 15 feet. Just this small, tight circle.
So I want to look at Ruka and give him a look of, like, I want to just go ahead and take out the dwarf, like, just right off the bat while his back is to us. So what do you think, Ruka?
Fuck. Oh, I don't want to say his name. Big guy first.
Daz it is. Alrighty.
Quite big.
So I guess at this point I'm gonna go ahead and enter rage mode and you say Daz is in front of us, right?
You have to you directly in front of you, Voltar. To your right, Daz. I mean you need to take a 5 foot step. You'll be in combat with Daz though, if that's what you're looking for.
With my 5 foot reach.
Yeah.
So I think I'm gonna take a step back, kind of move, position myself behind.
Mm-hmm.
Behind Daz.
Yep.
Start my rage mode, but maybe try to keep my attention and my looks like I'm still focused on the impending attackers.
Okay.
So that I don't, make Daz suspicious.
All right, so as you kind of take a sidestep, you feel that moment, that heat of just as it boils over slightly. Your knuckles whiten as they squeeze the axe. What would you like to do? Are you attacking? Or are you waiting? You can hold an action if you would like. You can only hold an act like an attack. You can't hold a movement or bonus things, so you can rage and step close. And if you would like to say hold an attack until you're attacked, or you or Daz turns on you, or something like that, you can set a trigger for your attack, or you can just attack him now.
I'm gonna say we should probably just go ahead and attack him.
Okay, go for it, man. Roll away. Let's see what you've got.
All right, and for that I roll 1d12, right?
Could I cast Bardic Inspiration on Phil?
Not until your turn, brother. Right? It's not a is it a reaction? Ooh, it might be a reaction.
I thought it was a reaction.
It might be. Hold on.
I could be wrong. I'm probably wrong.
Cutting words is your reaction, which if you're being attacked or somebody's attacking one of your friends, you can as a reaction say something or do something to try to throw somebody the enemy off to not mm-hmm. hurt your friend. So if he's about to hit your friend with a sword, you're like, ah, you're fat and ugly. And he's like, ah, you know, and then he stumbles and missing the attack, things like that. But your actual inspiration is on your turn.
Gotcha.
All right. So I guess I'm just rolling a 1d12, right?
D20 first to see if you hit.
16
against Daz. Oh no, Daz, where? Where's your...
Oh.
Don't worry about it. It's fine.
Batty merch, by the way.
So, I mean, that's just 16 period, right? Or do I add initiative?
You would add your attack next to it. So if we look at your character sheet, you see Great Axe, which is hit DC plus 4. See that on there?
Yep.
Okay.
Got it.
I'm just trying to make sure you're kind of learning as you go where to look.
That'll be at 20 then.
Perfect. So with an unnatural 20, you definitely hit. Go ahead and roll that D12 for damage now. As Daz is like, just kind of lumbering, looking at the dummies that are just standing there, like, what the fuck's happening? Just not expecting this hit.
That's going to be 11 plus 2, so 13.
Okay. So as you take a moment, you sidestep axe in hand as Voltar turns looking at you first, Gaikon. You raise your axe and just sweep it across the back of Daz, who you kind of feel like you understand a little bit about him being a massive orc and dressed in furs, giant hammer. You seem to have caught him before he maybe have gone into a rage. As you slice open his back, blood sprays off of it. As he roars out, very aware of the enemy now. Anything else you'd like to do? You have some movement left, but if you leave his, if you step away from him, he'll get what's called an attack of opportunity as you try to step back. Or you can just hang out if you're good to go.
I'm just going to hang out.
All right. Next in the order, Ruka.
Those of us playing the home game, how large is this area? Like 30 by 30?
Yeah, I'd say probably closer to 25 by 25, the space in between the cart and the barn itself. And you're all right on that back right corner of the cart. I wish, I have my own little
boop. Oh, okay, good. That's exactly what I'm doing.
It's hard to see, okay, I know. Sorry. It. I can't focus it for you.
Okay, so I would like to, I want to use my movement to get up on top of the cart.
Okay.
And if I can get from the elevated position, if I can get flanked with Gaikon on Daz, I want to come down with a short sword for a stink attack.
So you're already technically, you were on Daz's right side. You're already there. You're ready. You just move 5 feet forward. You don't even need to get on the cart. You'll have that flank. It was Voltor, Daz, Gaikon, and then you, Ruka. So if Gaikon pushed in, you just move around and you're already there. You don't even need to. You two are already flanking Daz.
Okay, I'll take it. I want to go for his kidney.
Roll away.
He's so...
with advantage or no?
Oh, yeah, with advantage. No, you are flanking. And you're a rogue. You get that, right? That's a thing?
That's a natural 20, my friend.
Ooh! Right in the kidney.
It was an 11 and a 20.
So, do orcs have one or two kidneys?
We're about to find out. You take a moment as you watch as Daz's back is ripped open. He turns over his left shoulder, looking at Gaikon, getting ready to rage. Just that impending hate flowing as he reaches for his hammer. Not even having a moment to look to his right, you just sidestep behind him, dagger out. It just slides in like nothing.
As roll he whispers, damage. You're really big.
You're quite big.
With sneak attack on top of that.
26 points of slashing damage.
Ooh,
fuck.
Yikes.
You just slide the dagger in, and as you feel it just almost touches bone somewhere, you spin it and rip it out. Blood flows out. As he just starts yelling again. He's frantically looking at enemies all around him now.
Hang on one sec. I gotta see something real quick.
Yep. Just so you know, Brorux, you'll be soon. So you're on deck, brother.
Okay. So because I hit him, I wanna back up and move and put something between me and Voltar, whether it's the cart or whether it's the actual barn itself, whatever's closer.
It'd be the cart, and so I'm assuming you're disengaging, bonus action?
Mobile, because I hit him with a bonus act, or because I hit him, he doesn't get opportunity.
That's, oh shit. Mobile's cool.
It's paying off. I'm so happy.
I get, that's cool, man. So yeah, you shank him. You would have to just wrap around, burning probably 10 feet of movement to move behind the cart, putting the cart in between you, in between Voltar and Daz. You're able to just...
Then I would like to use my bonus action to hide.
Give me that stealth roll.
Cheeky cut.
For a natural one.
as you kind of stab, slide away. You are large. As you spin around, and as you get behind this cart, right when you get ready to kind of slide in, your foot catches the wheel, and you stumble for a minute. It was this close to being super fucking cool, and then you fell, poof, dust and dirt kicks up. You're like, ah, as you kind of scramble back up.
Can I let out a, oh, bless your heart.
You get out of bless your heart. Brooks, as you get ready to act, somebody does happen to go before you, though. Sariandi.
Piss balls.
Bow drawn. Her standing behind Clover and Broax, because she was trying to pushing you forward. We gonna hit. Okay. Bow drawn. She sees Ruka stumble for a moment and get behind the cart. She takes one step back. Releases an arrow.
Yep, I deserve that.
It's over a 20. 22 to hit?
Just barely. That's
just,
my AC.
Just barely gets you?
Okay. Okay.
Well, that's not super bad. Okay, oh, never mind. It's a crit.
Ooh.
Sorry. That's going to hurt. Never mind.
Cough blood.
That's a terrible roll. You'll be fine. 8, 10, 11. Oh, one more.
Carry the one.
24. Oh, sorry, 26.
I'm unconscious.
Points of piercing damage.
Oh, that's a big
yike. Step back, arrow drawn, looses a bolt. As you take a moment to slide behind the cart, arrow directly to your throat. As you all, at least Clover and Broix, look to your left and immediately see just an arrow from Ruka's throat as he hits a knee and falls to his side, bleeding out behind the cart. Sariandi. One down. She steps back, bow drawn for a second attack. Roax, it's your turn.
Question, how close is she to me?
10 feet behind you. She just took a single step back, getting ready for anybody else.
Alright, I just wanna, like, just turn straight to her, and, I wanna hit her with, lightning breath.
Yeah, so you turn, you look over, and as you open your mouth, you just a little these little crackles of lightning. And that is a, what kind of save is that? Is that a deck save?
Yeah.
It is dex?
Yep.
Okay. Oh, shit. I'm gonna assume a 9 fails.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, damn. So yeah, as you take a moment, your mouth, you see your friend drop, as you look over your shoulders, as this lightning starts crackling around you, as you breathe, as this lightning bolt just cracks out, thunderclap close, deafening everyone for a moment, as the blinding light, as you watch her bow drawn, ready to fire, not expecting this, she tries diving out of the way. Not making it. Go ahead and roll damage on that.
Damage my case. 2d6, correct?
Yes, sir.
10 together.
Okay. As it cracks through her, you see her almost hit the, just drop to the ground. It singes all up her arm and part of her shoulder. Ah! As she tries to get another arrow knocked, having lost one there. Anything else you'd like to do, bro?
Not sure what else I could do besides just try to move.
Do you have any bonus actions?
I don't think I have any
bonus actions. Bardic Inspiration, brother. You can, as long as somebody's within 60 feet of you, you can inspire somebody, giving them a D6 that can be added onto an attack, an ability check, or a save. Death saves are also saves.
Yeah, definitely use Bardic Inspiration on old Ruka boy. All
right, Ruka, you have a D6 ready for you. So on his next save, or if he's brought back up with health on his next turn, he has a D6 that he can use. So you have three of those, just so you know, bro. So yeah, one's gone. Yeah, two more you can use on other turns.
Yep.
Clover, you take a moment as lightning crackles past you. You see your friend, your childhood friend that you've known for so long, on the ground, clutching his neck, blood pouring from his fingers as his eyes start to stare up aimlessly.
Okay. I'm going to go ahead and cast Ice Knife, second level, on Sariandi.
Okay.
That's going to be a dirty 20 to hit.
Well, that hits. Roll damage.
Okay.
You watch is that momentary panic, seeing your friend on the ground before you focus one more time, thinking of all the different spells and everything you had in, and then you think, the one who did this. Sariandi, as you turn, you hold out your hands, drawing the moisture from the air as it hardens into a long crystal as you throw it forward, spiraling at Sariandi.
Gonna be 4 damage for piercing.
Yep.
And then they have to make a dexterity saving throw because it explodes.
I have a 17 for her save. I don't know what your save is.
It's
13.
She saves it.
Oh, okay. So she manages, as this dagger, her still on the ground trying to get up after just dodging a bolt of lightning, this ice knife shing straight through her shoulder, as it melts and leaves this bloody wound there. And then just as it's about to explode, she dives out of the way as it shatters. How much damage?
4.
And she takes half, right?
No, it's 4 damage and then it explodes into more damage.
Yeah, but she passed her save on the more damage. Is it half or does she take none?
She takes none.
Oh, okay, sorry. All right, anything else you'd like to do, Clover?
I would like to go ahead and wild shape as a bonus action into a bear.
Oh, use a bear. As you watch this small form first start sprouting claws. She's a massive brown bear? Sure.
Yeah, brown bear.
Brown bear, a little clover bear. All right.
It's like a cub.
More like a build bear.
I just realized they didn't roll initiative for Fulsar. 8. Perfect. Last.
Get fucked.
But after Clover, Daz turns. Ooh. Looking on his right where this massive source of damage came from. He doesn't see anyone there. He turns again. Gaikon. Hammer drawn out. You see him as he just roars wildly, just starts swinging this massive hammer. That is a 22 to hit, which I think it's you, brother.
Yep, I'm 17.
Oh, wrong dice.
Hey, buddy, could I use that cutting words right now as an action to him swinging?
You could indeed.
I would like to do that.
All right, so what are you saying to try to throw Daz off?
As I hear him like start screaming, start yell up, and like I turn over, I see him, and it's like Gaikon's about to get fucking clobbered.
Yep.
I'm about, ah, now, boy, you over there, your big head looking at that, going on down there, go bend over there with that, yeah, there, gun now, boy.
Roll a d6 for me. Mark off another one of your inspiration. This uses your bardic inspiration, so you lose one more there. Roll it.
6.
Ooh! As he turns the swing, he just, as the hammer goes wide, completely missing Gaikon at this point. Just going straight over his head.
Oh, but Dad, you want
guess
shit.
There's no chance he accidentally hit Daz, right?
No, that was Daz swinging. No chance he didn't hit Voltor, though. This is Daz, then Voltor.
Yeah.
As he just swings wide. But his second attack. That's only a 19.
Two
what?
Armor class is 17.
Oh, shit. I thought your armor class was... I don't know why I thought it was so high. So the second attack, 5, 8. You take 8 bludgeoning damage, halved to 4, because you're raging already. As a note, you saw him as he was swinging wildly, almost recklessly. Any attacks by any of you on Daz have advantage now, just so you know. He has foregone his own safety to try to murder. He seems to kind of sidestep closer to Voltar to almost try to post up, just hammer, breathing wildly, his eyes just glazed over, not even thinking, just swinging. That brings us to Voltar, though. Who is going to come at you, Gaikon, being the target right there. All right, that first one's a miss. That's only a fucking 12? 12 doesn't hit you. So he takes his dagger out as he stabs once. You're able to just knock it out of the way with your axe like it's nothing. His second attack comes in with a short sword. That is a 18 to hit, which you said it was a 17, right? Okay, so the short sword comes at you. That's good. 10 slashing damage. So as you parry the blade, he goes underneath of it with his short sword stabbing at you. 5, though. As you raging, brother. You feel these little scuffs in this. The hammer hits you in the shoulder. The sword slashes your side. You don't even feel it. This is nothing. Back at the top of the order. Jackal. And as this is going on, this next round, you hear what sounds like just chaos all around you. Outside the back of the barn, you hear people screaming, swords clanging. It seems as you kind of look over in that direction, you see the barn doors rip open as a few guards come running out. And they seem to have engaged in fighting whoever was brought over with Voltor. So Voltor's henchmen are now fighting guards out on the side. As Jackal kind of looks over his shoulder, kill them all! As he charges forward at Daz with his rapier.
He's so goddamn cool.
Shut up, you're almost dead.
Yeah, there we go. That's what I want to hear. Perfect.
Body pillow for this after.
I can just imagine him going, he's so cool.
As he died, that's his dying breath. So Daz is flanked for our friend. So that's 7, 14. And a whole bunch of this. 10, 15, 18 plus 28 damage. As you watch this rapier come out, and as he's in this fencing stance, it's high. Daz turns, he just comes over, stabs him straight down into his shoulder. Oh! As he kind of spins around him, stabs him another time. Almost dancing around behind Daz. As at this point, you watch Daz wheezing. as he's panicking, as there's people all around him stabbing him, blood pouring from all these small wounds, the jackal again flourishes his blade, and as he just kind of gives him a little, come at me. Gaikon, what would you like to do?
All right. First off, I want to move and position myself so that Daz is between me and... Bless, what's the frickin'...
Voltor? Voltar, sorry. I keep saying Voltor.
Voltor.
Yeah, you're able to kind of squeeze... Daz was right up kind of next to him, but you know, with your strength, you're able to muscle your way. You're tight in there. It's a clusterfuck, but you're in there. Daz breathing over top of you. Blood just pouring from this poor bastard.
All right, so I guess now I'm just going to go ahead and swing on him, on Daz.
Oh, yeah, let's do it. Roll and attack.
I'm rolling...
D20 first.
D20?
And then that's where you're going to add that attack to hit chance.
Actual 20.
Shit. Oh. So that's going to hit. Roll that D12, and then double whatever you roll.
Gonna miss him.
That's a 8, so 16.
Then you add on your extra damage too. You don't double the extra damage, you only double the dice. 18. I think it's more than that, brother. Hold on real quick. Because your great axe, so you have a 16 alone from damage, plus 2, plus your raging, which adds 2, I believe, right?
Oh, does it? Then we missed out on damage earlier. Damn it.
So, yeah, so you get to add an extra plus 2. Just remember that. So it doesn't say that. See that there's a little note section?
I see it down there. I see it. Yeah, I do remember us discussing that before.
Cool. So, yeah, as you... that
the 20.
Exactly. So another 20 damage as Daz is panicking, looking behind him again as he was just stabbed from behind for the second time by a different person. As you take your axe, you spin it once in your hand. As you bring it up, how exactly do you cleave Daz?
Well, I'm going for the neck.
With one swoop, as you as you swipe his head.
Ah, damn!
As it bounces on the ground, his body standing. You see for a moment as it moves, almost like it taking a step towards you, as it falls to a knee.
Kick right into Voltor.
As Daz,
you were quite large.
Has left the building, folks. All right, Gaikon. You have...
Stage right.
You just turn around, facing Voltor, who at this moment, he's been pretty cool with things. Panic.
Pants filled with shit at this point.
Hey, Ruka? Can I get your first death saving throw, please?
Do I or do I not get to use my bardic inspiration?
You 100% get to use that bardic inspiration to add to it.
That's a 14.
Okay. So, for a moment, you're still unconscious, you're still bleeding, but the blood flow seems to have just slowed slightly. You're not in imminent danger of dying, but you're not out of the woods yet. Sariandi's turn.
I'm a bear.
That you are.
And I just want to make sure that she knows I'm staring directly into her soul.
All right.
Gnarly.
Let's see. Sariandi. Bow drawn. I think she's going to come for you, bro.
Bet.
No, she's going to attack. No, she'll attack, bro. Yeah, you're the one who shot lightning at her. So she steps back, sees you, bow drawn. She's going to roll. 15 to hit.
Yeah, that hits.
Okay. So it's not going to be as bad because there's no sneak attack on it, which is good for you. As she draws, looses an arrow, it kind of grazes off your shoulder, but you take 8 points of piercing damage. This arrow, sing, slices through your side. At that point, she's gonna move back like 20 feet, kind of trying to get back in, and she kind of ducks behind a tree, trying to hide. For a moment, you guys kind of lose sight of her as she dives behind these trees into the darkness of these bushes and such. Just back. She's moving away from the light, moving away from the fight. Broix, it's your turn.
So safe to say she's like, what, 30 feet away now?
Closer to 45 from you, because she was originally 10 or so. Then she moved back five her first turn, and then she just did a full 30 back. And again, you're not quite sure where she's dipped to.
Yeah, true, true. All right, what's Voltar currently doing? Just panicking?
He is being glared at by a raging dwarf and now a elven inquisitor.
Okay,
Ruka's on the ground bleeding out, and then
I guess use my last little bit of Bart. Yeah, let's do my inspiration on Ruka.
Just so you know, you have healing spells. Go ahead and
now will it bring him out? Will it bring him out of it?
Like, coming up above 1 HP immediately removes that.
Yeah, I
just
reckon. So
you, just in case you didn't know.
I reckon I should do Cure Wound.
You take that quick 10-foot run as you step over, see him bleeding out, arrow in his throat. You kind of pull the arrow out. You hear a gurgle for a moment as you slam your scaly hand over his throat. Go ahead and roll for your Cure Wounds. Do you know what that is?
It says 1d8. Plus 3, so
I heard everything.
I'm gonna save you, big boy. 7 and then 7 plus 3.
10. Yep. Ruka, you wake to a dragon mouth snout right in your face, hand around your throat as he's plugging the holes. 10 HP.
Get off my little buddy, it's not over. Yeah, it's not over for you, one goddamn bit.
So yeah, Cure Wounds is a touch spell, so you have to like physically grab them. I don't know if you have Healing Word. I think you just have Cure Wounds.
Yeah, just Cure Wounds. Also, as I'm healing, I kind of want my back facing towards him, almost like shielding him almost. That way, like, he can't catch another hot arrow.
Okay, of course. You kind of cover him, tail wrapped around the side of him as using your back as a shield. But you still can give out inspiration if you'd like to somebody else or him. Or hold on to it for now.
No,
I didn't use my inspiration last for my save.
So you already have one. So he still has one too.
So let me go ahead and let me just use it on Jazzy or fucking Clover.
All right, yeah. How are you inspiring her?
Question: with her in bear form, does she understand?
Only one way to find out.
All right. Let me call out to her, and
is Clover close enough for me to use my animal inspiration to communicate and relay? I have to be like right on top of her, don't I?
Can I explain what wild shape is, Daddy? Just so they know.
Yes. Oh yeah, yeah. Sure.
To be fair, all there. So.
So basically, when I wild shape, I'm still me. I'm just an animal form. So I understand. I know what I'm doing. I understand everything.
She retains all her mental stats, so like her intelligence, the languages she would know. She can't speak them back to you, but she can, you know, bear growl at you, I guess. But she can understand anything just said to her, so you wouldn't actually really need to. You could. You could speak bear back at her if you'd like.
Let's go that route. You know, me, you know, not never seeing something like this before. Yeah, I see her in a bear. I'm just like, you know, I've seen enough bears in my travels, and like, I feel like I can, you know, at least say something in like some sort of bear language.
Yeah.
I'm gonna look at her, just. Rrr!
Clover, as you look over your shoulder,
give her a thumbs up.
You see a thumbs up dragon growling at you, roaring at you. It's Okay, take your D6 inspiration though. Let you have an inspiration you can use on your next go round, or it lasts a minute for anybody. Okay.
Sounds good.
Clover, on that wonderful point, it is your turn. What are you up to?
Because I have, looks like, keen smell, would I be able to smell Sariandi's blood and see if I can?
You can make a perception check. Does that give you advantage on the check?
Yeah, it does.
Give me an give me perception with advantage. You're trying to beat her stealth roll.
15.
So as you take a moment, you bury your snout to the ground. As you lift your head looking, with all the blood around you, it's kind of throwing off the scent. You're not sure where she is, no. You know the general direction, but not her exact position.
Okay, in that case, am I able to grapple Voltar with my bear claws?
You 100% can.
I'm gonna do that.
All right, as you kind of turn around, as you just come just prancing or whatever, trample, whatever
prance.
A bear does towards this dwarf who already has, so he has a raging dwarf and a bear. I'm gonna give you advantage on the strength check too. I mean, fuck.
Okay. That's a 9. Actually, wait.
You do have inspiration.
Oh yeah, I rolled a 7 first. Math is hard. 11, and I will use my inspiration.
Okay.
And that's gonna make it a 13.
So close.
So close. Would that be considered an attack?
So it's a grapple check, which it's your strength contesting his athletics or acrobatics. He rolled low too, but he has just a little bit more. What do you got?
I have multi-attack. Can I try again?
No, a grapple uses the entire action. It's an action to grapple versus an attack itself.
Okay.
So you just start slamming your paws, but seemingly he's just dodging and using the wagon to almost trying to clamber underneath of it. You're not able to completely grapple him, but you two are pinning him pretty squarely right now. He could still get away, but not without lots of attacks.
Gotcha.
Daz is bleeding out on the ground. He's dead. It is Voltar's turn, though. Huh.
Read character sheet in DM.
That right? I'm running out of options here. So first thing, what are you doing? The fuck is this shit? As he's panicking, visibly fucked, as his bodyguard's headless next to him. He's gonna take his sword, lash out at it at the bear first.
Hit me, I dare you.
That is a 22 to hit with the short sword.
It hits.
Yeah,
it does.
That's a natural 17 or 15. Short sword's a D6. And you take 8 piercing damage as he stabs into you with his short sword. Just panicking again, this tiny dwarf. And he's going to lash out with his second attack against Gaikon, but... As the first stat hits the bear, as he turns wildly swinging at you, Gaikon. I mean, you don't even need to parry the attack. He swings so wide, just panicking at this point. But he Gaikon's is going... What was that?
I said Gaikon's going to split him in half.
He is going to use his bonus action to disengage. As
he's going to attack.
As a rogue-ish feature... Nope. He has a thing called disengage, which Ruka usually uses, where he can stop opportunity attacks from hitting him by using his bonus action to be sneaky. So as he's kind of pinned up against this cart, dodging bear paws, he kind of just drops to the ground and pushes himself under the cart. So he's not moving as fast as he can because he's literally crawling under a cart, but he can't incur any attacks. As you go to swing, Gaikon, the axe just wedges square in the cart right above his head. As he crawls, he pops up on the other side of the cart. So he's only 10 feet or so away, but there's a cart in between all of you now. It is the jackal's turn.
Say, is the cart between Jackal as well?
Yeah, so everybody's on the inside, but he...
Was it Jackal? I thought Jackal was on the opposing side of him, though.
He was, but not on the opposite side of the cart. He was on the other end of it, so the front of it versus you guys all fighting at the back. But he's gonna loop around. As you watch the Jackal loop around, Yeah, he's gonna do it.
He's so cool.
He's so cool.
Alright, so you watch as the Jackal watches him dive onto the cart. He just takes a moment, sprints to the edge of the cart, hits it, jumps over the cart, lands so cool. As Voltor climbs back out, sword ready. You just hear, as you hear Voltor scream out as a sword stabs into him.
So cool.
So cool.
All right, coming back to Gaikon's turn. He's just under the cart from you. Seriandi seems to be off in the woods at this point. Yeah, you could crawl after him, honestly. Being a dwarf, it wouldn't be too hard. You'd use your full movement to go just hit the ground, crawl, pop back up, or you could kind of you could use your full movement and run around the cart as well. Up to you.
Say, I think I'm just gonna circle the cart so I have room for a full swing.
Oh hell yeah! So you wedge the axe out of the cart where you just missed him as you roll around the back of it, sprinting around. As you come around, you see the Jackal just kind of pull the rapier back out of his shoulder as Voltor is now pinned against the cart. What are you doing?
Swinging for the stands, man.
All right, go ahead and make your attack.
All right, I'm doing D12, right?
First D20.
D20. Hold on.
I smell a natural 20.
It's another natural 20.
Oh, fuck. Damn.
Roll that D12, brother.
That's a 5 doubled plus 4, so 14.
All right. As you come around that cart, Voltor is focused almost completely on the Jackal who just pinned him to the cart with a sword and pulled it. As you just slide around, axe already swinging, just not even looking, as it just cleaves directly down his arm and side, blood squirt just sprays out everywhere. Ah, what are you... No! Stop! Leave me! Is he still alive? But, ouch.
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 Minecraft oof noy.
Going to the next up, Ruka. As you're alive, what are you doing, brother?
I'm gonna spit that bloody loogie out of my throat.
Oh yeah, and, it's bad.
I'm gonna roll to my feet, and I get the sense that Voltor is handled.
Because you were on that side of the cart, so it's Broek standing over you, kind of protecting you. And as you look over your right shoulder, Gaikon is there, just cleaving into Voltor with the Jackal, pinning him as well.
Does he appear mortally wounded or close to it?
Looking at him, give me a medicine check.
Oh. 8.
8? Looking at him, I mean, there's blood fucking everywhere. Your blood, little his blood, blood all over the ground leaking from the giant orc that was cleaved. It's hard to tell, honestly, how hurt he may be.
I'm just gonna try to speak to Gaikon through his rage, and Jackal said he wants him alive, and then I'll just jump into the back of the cart. And I suppose would I have any idea that Seriandi ran into the woods?
You were unconscious at the time of her heading into the woods. You can roll perception with disadvantage. You can look for her, but you missed the entire incident of her disappearing, so.
Disadvantage was a 10.
Okay, so as you take a moment, kind of coming to your senses, looking around, Broek's kind of hovering over you, you have no idea where she is. She's just not on the battlefield.
I'm going to jump in the cart and, draw the bow right over Gaikon's head, I'm assuming, because vertical angle.
Yeah.
Onto Voltor. and just say to him, yield or die like the rest. Make your choice. And tell the bitch to come out of hiding.
Roll intimidation.
Am I good at that?
I don't know.
That's so cool.
I'm kind of good at that.
What was that?
13.
Okay. You watch briefly as he looks up now, the dwarf that just cleaved him in half, a rapier at his throat, and a bow drawn at the top of his head. Yield. Yield as you watch him hold hands, drop both dagger and his short sword and dagger. As he steps back into the cart and kind of slumps down on his ass at the, on the edge of the wagon.
Does Ariandi come out?
Well, it's her turn next. We're going to find out, I think.
So before I end my turn, do I have any sort of cover from the tree line? Like, does the wagon have a back on it? Or, like, any cargo in there? Can I hide behind a dummy?
The dummies, you'd have to drop back to the ground. They're down on the ground. But you could.
I will use
the cart is very low. I mean, you'd have to, like, prone out in the cart to hide from it.
Okay. I'll get behind the dummy.
Okay, after you threaten him and he looks at everybody surrounding him and a bear as well that he knows is right there, he seems to be yielding as he drops his weapons and you hop on the cart and get behind as it is Sirianni's turn. She's going to take one more shot. Broix. You were the one who shot lightning and was shielding her kill. You're going to take some damage here, brother. What is there to hit? Yeah, it's a 23 to hit.
Yeah.
Mm-mm, 10, 13, 14, 15. Another D6 to drop here, bud.
Kill that bitch, please.
20.
Hell yeah.
20 piercing damage.
Taking a little nap.
As Sirianni, in the woods, unawares to most of you at this point, as the arrow catches, and Ruka, as you're getting ready to jump off the cart, back behind it, you just in time to watch an arrow strike him in the spine, in the back of the neck. As he flattens in the pool of blood where you just were, unconscious.
Mm-hmm.
For a moment in the woods, as it sounds distant, you hear somebody yell out, "You'll all pay for this!" And she seems to be in the woods.
Can I just make a blind shot with a bow where the sound came from?
Yeah, roll disadvantage.
That would have been an 18. That's actually not bad. 19.
As you take a moment, you take your bow over the cart, listening for the sound, you close your eyes for a moment. No sound.
Fuck.
Are we out of initiative at this point?
At this point. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to immediately drop out of my bear form and cast Goodberry and
pop Bear attack!
And pop a couple Goodberries into Boba Mess.
Don't get into that Boba.
So as the giant bear is Clover standing up, staff in hand, taps it on the ground, little berries start sprouting all over it. You hear kind of off in the distance, not far distance, but over near the barn still, the chaos that was over there is dying down as well. So we've subdued them! And it sounds a different voice, somewhat familiar, as Clover plucks a berry and just starts chewing with the dragon maw.
I'm gonna give him 5.
Giving him 5. Oh yeah. So, Brooks, as you kind of start coming to a small hand being shoved in your mouth as she starts shoving more berries in there after.
Batty, you said that the voice was awfully familiar. Is it someone from the boat?
Man, that sounds a lot like a certain captain.
I'm sticking with Jackal. I'll come out of hiding, help Brorex to his feet, and kind of pat Clover on the head.
I'm gonna swat at him with my staff, and as I swat at him, I'm gonna motion for the berries for him.
So as 5. He's on the ground and the berries being passed out, for a brief moment, quiet, you see Voltar sitting on the ground as a group of familiarly garbed individuals, 3 of them, come walking around from behind the barn. Bloody swords in hand, some scars on them. And at that point, we're gonna take a quick break! All right. That was fun. Hey guys,
that was fucking fun.
Does anyone want to try to win some dice? Maybe a giveaway? I don't know. Sounds like it might be kind of fun, huh?
Yeah.
Fucking chess.
Now come on up in there. No. When you all dog, good old dice now, boys.
I gotta do.
You gotta do what to do.
Everybody with goddamn bot boy.
Jesus, you're all out of control. You're out of control. You're the greatest. I love you all. We are gonna give away a set of dice right in this moment coming up here at the end of the break. As soon as I'm gonna roll it, we're gonna pick them. And when we get to the end of the break, I'll announce who won. And also at the very end of the episode, end of the session, we're gonna give away a second set of dice. So real quick, let me go get the dice so I can pick out which ones y'all are gonna win. I'm not gonna show you until obviously you win, but I'll be right back. Enjoy some ominous tunes.
PP time.
Thanks.
Hey, we didn't die. We did good.
Yeah, okay.
Wait.
One hit.
Wait, I lied. Hold on.
Oh fuck.
No, you can go. You're good, yes.
Back.
We're gonna start allowing, I'm gonna open the giveaway first. So it's gonna be available to everyone. There's gonna be a cool keyword. What is our keyword? I kind of like the idea that the keyword. Okay, there we go. We got it. Now, I'm not going to turn on anti-spam yet. In the future, I'm probably going to do this. Only put in the fucking code word once and you'll be in, okay? Like right now, if you do it multiple times, it's not going to disqualify you. But in the future, to prevent nonstop spam of giveaway shit, I'm going to do that right now. You just need to put in the code word, which is !! Cool. COOL. Because Jackal is so fucking cool, guys. So if you'd like a chance to win, !! In chat. Type it now. Go, because the Jackal's cool.
So. Hey, Ray-Ban. How you doing, bud?
Yo, Burbs. All right, guys, we're doing doodles. Fucking $2 doodle. No, just kidding.
Find us real content. Who wants to see Batty with tit? I mean, Holy moly.
All right. It's like
the most glorious restroom break ever.
Let me get the dice out real quick. Little cute little bag. I would love some baddie dice though. I want to give away baddie dice. Fucking awesome. Or just dice what with is... all ones on them.
Or at least color scheme, like just blue and orange.
Yeah, yeah.
Might have a set of blue and orange ones. Matter of fact, like I'm pretty certain I do.
A special set where if like you hit like a one, it's like either like baddie hands or like baddie feels bad instead of just the one there.
I,
like...
I just want the six to be bad die.
The end of the stream, I want to. Some lucky person's gonna win a set of metal ones.
Oh, I was gonna just give away a set of these. Are you doing? Are you giving away shit?
Yeah, at the end of the stream. Okay. We discussed this earlier.
I thought it was just gonna be the regular ones I was giving away. I already mentioned it, but yeah, cool. All right, so.
So we'll have time. We'll do the polyurethane ones, and then finishing off, let's do a set of metals.
Okay, there you go. So guys, exclamation cool, COOL, because the jackal is so cool.
So cool.
Do that in chat right now, and I'll show you guys the dice here. There's some fancy blue. I can't really focus on them because my camera just doesn't. In a little cute dice bag. I'll be mailing these out hopefully early next week for y'all. Whoever's the winner. Everybody in?
I'm
everybody
just
going
to have the metal one shipped straight to you guys.
Yeah.
Cut out the middle.
Ooh, fancy.
I hope I win.
You want dice touched by the DM? Do I rub them on my beard?
Like... Never mind. I don't.
I'm definitely.
I'll wait for Golden's.
All right, then. Everybody good? Exclamation cool. Now, hurry. All right, we're rolling it. Kratos! Is there a Kratos in chat?
I don't.
Mr. Kratos? Hello? Oh, no. The first giveaway. Is he not here? Oh, he's here. Okay.
Hell yeah. There we go.
So Kratos, if you could please join Discord, exclamation Discord real quick. Hop in there, shoot me a message. You'll see my name right at the top. It's the big douchebag himself. I will chat with you and we'll get these out. Or you can message me on Twitch, I guess, either way, whatever fucking works, brother. At the end of the episode, after we're done this session, I'll get with you. We'll chat. It'll be great.
What you got there, small woman?
That's a
my
good
mom's
idea.
Homemade rum cake.
Yes.
I fucking hate you.
All right, real quick. Let me see. I think I got a couple alerts I just want to yell at real quick. Followed. What do we got? Sampos, Max. Thanks, guys. Partying the host earlier. Tropical list. Well, it's subs, BB. Oh, God. Slush was in here. I didn't even see him. Fuck.
Can you please read his message, Patty?
Lick my leathery sack.
Thank you.
Grizz, thank you for the fucking sub and militia.
He's referring to his coin purse.
No, he's talking about the bottom side of Brorux's tail.
Brorux, just so you know, that message reflects on you. Sent, thanks, Kratos. Perfect. I'll get to you, brother. It's not going to be great.
Man, I assume I'm already dead, so.
I mean, not anymore. You technically are not dead yet.
Shame.
With that, is everybody good to go? You need any more time?
I'm good.
All right.
Good.
Thank you, everybody in chat, for hanging out. Again, real quick, now that we're back, we have Golden Icon playing Gaikon, the Mountain Dwarf Barbarian, Jazzy Wazzy 94 playing Clover, our little forest gnome druid, Gobro Buffett, the one, the only, the terrible, playing Broix.
Known in the number.
Our bronze dragonborn bard. Oh, no. I'll figure that out one of these days. What was that? Jesus. And oh god. And Gaddy playing Ruka Delance, our half elf rogue.
Jackal's so fucking cool.
He's so cool.
He's so cool.
He's just so cool.
And on that, as the battlefield goes quiet, Broix is kind of
mouthful
of
berries
on the ground, trying to compose himself. Gaikon standing over Voltar, who seems to have dropped to his ass, hands in the air. The jackal.
At least the one that still works.
I mean, yeah, one of his arms is not looking great. There's a lot of bad happening over there.
I'm going to turn to Voltar while he's on the ground and say, maybe we're not quite so fucking useful. Now I'll...
If his eyes were daggers, he would have just critted you, I swear. The look he's giving back at you is hellish.
Let's go come back and bite you in the ass. I hope you know that.
I'm going to look at Jackal and say, wow, you're really cool.
That was very impressive, mate. I've never seen somebody fight with a sword that thin before.
Well,
Maddie, do I have time to strum Voltor like a quick tune? Just after I get done swallowing the berries and I see that he's fucked and he's lost.
As Jackal's getting, as Jackal's kind of walking around the cart towards to greet a special captain, you have a moment.
Okay, I just want to like whistle for Voltor, but hey, no boy. Got something for you now. I'm gonna give it like a big old like. Sucks to suck. And then put my guitar down and just continue.
Does that work as any form of intimidation? You know, to just kind of keep him at bay.
He is submitted at this point. There's zero fight left in him. There is a dwarf with a massive axe standing over him, and he's flanked all around. He understands. The writing's on the wall, if you will. But after this little sucks the suck, he kind of shifts his hellish gaze to you.
I just want to give him like a berry-filled smile, like...
Oh yeah, toothy, like maw covered in little red berries and shit. Yeah. It looks actually kind of ominous, as it looks like your mouth's filled with blood, which actually it is also filled with blood because you had an arrow in the back of the neck. A lot of neck shots going around. It's something you want to avoid, guys.
If I could look at Voltar and say, and just like my father told me, always be a step ahead of the enemy.
Now,
Voltar,
as he kind of
starts crying,
looks up. Y'all better watch yourselves, because if I get the chance, I swear. And as before he can finish his sentence, a boot to the side of the head as the jackal walks up.
He's so cool.
Quite enough. And you see Voltar is kind of
I'm gonna nod at the jackal because I was literally about to do the same thing.
As Voltar is on the ground, unconscious.
Well, well done, friends. I see why you gave our friend some trouble out on the sea. Good work.
And as he says this, walking from behind the cart, Captain Tarek, all in uniform, a bit of a slash across his tunic. Yes, good work. As you see, there's definitely an anger to it, but seems to be trying to keep it professional.
I'm going to apologize to the captain. I didn't really mean to hurt you. Sorry.
Oh, hurt me. I'm fine. But the families of the two men you slain are grieving currently. Which was a wonderful conversation I had to have earlier today.
As you see him kind of just turn away from you. But And you see the jackal kind of hold the hand. Hey, yes. I understand some mistakes have been made, but we've hopefully started to amend them. Taking care of a certain issue as he looks his down. But on the other hand, we do seem to have a loose end. Seriandi, the elf. Slippery one. Strong, dangerous. An assassin. As she kind of looks at you two.
I kind of want to like rub the back of my neck real quick.
As you know.
I'm a killer bitch.
I would assume she's going to head to Sartle, but who knows? There's still Cape Town and Northwatch. There's a couple places she could go. We'll have to be on top of that. In the meantime, I think we need to take this one back to Ormskirk. I have some questions for him, and I also have some work for the rest of you, I believe. Not saying it's a continuation of our contract, but maybe to help amend some wrongs, as he kind of looks over to the captain. Some help for the town, maybe. Now, Captain, have your men clean up the mess in the back. And the rest of you, with me, please. As you see the jackal kind of grab him by, like, the scruff, he starts to lift him. Looks to you, Gaikon. Would you mind carrying this one for me?
No, I can help.
Run at him?
Yeah. As he just kind of drags
him. Leg and start dragging behind me.
With ease at that.
Betty, could I possibly peek around the barn and see the shit show that ensued on the other side?
Oh yeah, as everything's kind of packing up and moving, there's two guards still behind the barn. You saw three come out, Captain Tarek and two. You still two more back there. One's kind of wounded. It looks like his mate's tending to him there, and you see all or five of the members or mercenaries, whoever was working with Voltor, just splayed out. Dead daggers, arrows. It's they are murdered.
I would like to motion towards the others. It's like, oh, I'm over here. We gotta go, you know, pot the pockets down and whatnot. You know, I want to, you know, go over there, search some bodies and see if there's any like documents, gold, or like any sort of like, I guess, like upgrades in terms of like weaponry.
For sure. As you you call over to who?
I guess, well, Golden, Gaikon's holding Voltor. Yep. I guess it'd be Clover and Ruka. But I want to keep an eye out for like axes or, you know, stuff that Gaikon uses.
So as you kind of walk over and the other two is kind of following behind you, you hear a voice from, I think we'll let the sleeping men die. As you see the captain standing there kind of tapping his foot.
Then I want to hang my I want to pull out like my coin purse and be like, I'm running a little low. They might have something I need.
Of course. And he kind of reaches down. Better yet, let me take this back to the families of the men you've killed. I think that's payment enough.
Captain Tarek, I want to have a word with you about that.
As the jackal's just kind of standing there with a smirk on his face next to Gaikon.
I would just continue patting down.
Okay. The captain walks straight by you, Ruka, ignoring you. Sword, at this point, hand on the hilt. I'm only going to say this one more time. Stand up and head back to town. The only reason you live or not thrown away is because of that man, as he points to the jackal.
I
the
just
only
like
reason.
I want to snort, just interrupt him, snort, crack off lightning, walk past him. Go search Gaz.
Okay.
Captain Tarek.
He kind of looks over his shoulder at you. What?
One fighting man to another. I just want you to know that it was nothing personal. We're wayward souls. We're just trying to make a living, and I'm sorry that our paths are crossed in this way. When we're under employment with the Jackal, I would like to set up a fund for the families of the men. Whatever the Jackal pays me, I just need enough to eat, and the rest can go to the family.
Wayward souls don't murder those protecting them, those who took them in. That's more than just nothing personal, friend. As for gold from you, no thanks. Keep it. We'll have none of your blood money in this town. I want you gone. As he kind of turns and walks away.
Now we'll leave.
Well, I want to motion for Brorix to go check the pockets of the orc.
Mm-hmm. That. Yeah.
As well, and you know, give him a nice head nod towards the dwarf I'm dragging as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I mean, he has money on him, right?
No, Gaikon, please allow me. And I want to fucking just run his pockets inside out.
On Daz or Voltor?
Voltor. Yes.
Well, both, yeah.
Okay. As Broix heads over to Daz, you kind of grab this warhammer he was using, which is the maul he was using. It's mundane. It seems used, but it is a maul, so you could add that to your inventory, or I can get you with it after. I believe it's a D10. As Ruka, as you go to run them pockets, and you too, bro, again, leave the bodies alone. And the Jackal kind of walks up. For once, I'll have to agree. Leave Voltor and his possessions on him. I will have need for them myself. You will get paid. These are not some random kills in the woods. You are working with me and the god. Behave so.
Fair enough. And I want to take one of my gold coins that I own, and I want to like palm it, but still pass over Voltor, make it look like I just stole gold from him and just show it to him and put it back in my pouch.
Make a sleight of hand check.
Oh boy, that's a 24. Like a fucking gold coin trick behind his ears.
Yeah, you grab it, and the Jackal in front of you, with a flourish of his hand, pulls a dagger out. Fancy. As he kind of spins it across his fingers, and it's gone.
So.
As he turns.
Not impressed.
And begins the walk back to town.
Any reaction from Voltor?
He's unconscious. He got a boot to the head.
Oh fuck.
Yeah, okay. He's out.
I didn't realize that he was still unconscious.
No, you just, the Jackal's looking at you like, cool.
Okay,
Voltor,
no, okay.
Out cold.
Okay, never mind. That was it. That was supposed to be for Voltor. I thought he had woken up at some.
No. He got Das boot to the forehead. And at that, Gaikon's dragging him by his feet. So his head's just kind of wrapping off every other rock as he's walking back to town.
Okay, then just as the Jackal walks away from me and just under my breath, just he's so fucking cool.
Because he bites his bottom lip.
So fucking cool.
It doesn't take long.
Please. Yeah.
10 minutes, 15 minutes. The walk wasn't far. Very dark at this point. As you enter the town, a couple guards posted on the main road now. We are expecting you, sir. As they both kind of nod, give him a little nod, them both holding pikes as the Jackal leads the kind of somber, quiet walk in with Gaikon and Ruka. Gaikon dragging a very, at one point, nicely dressed velvet, just dwarf that's covered in blood and torn up, just dragging him, just bouncing his head. Ruka, Bro, and Clover in the back with Captain Tarek bringing up the column with a bit of a space. It's like he doesn't want to be near you guys or something. I don't know.
Do I notice if any guards are looking at Voltar like they were his employee?
I want to make a perception check.
Okay, it's a 19.
19? So as you kind of watch the two guards you saw posted, both of them do definitely look down at the unconscious man being dragged by his feet, but there doesn't seem to be any concern on the face of these two, at least. More like, sucks, dude.
Okay.
Yeah. As you continue into town, where you took alleys and back roads and such to get to the outskirts of town first, you take the main road in at this point. You pass closed stalls, houses, the very occasional commoner walking by, until you come to a very large building. Two stories, a large dirt pit out front with a small fence around it. As the jackal turns in, kind of standing at the gate, come now, to the keep. And this seems to be some sort of guards post or a building where a barracks. As he walks up the stairs, waits for you with the door open for you all to walk in. When you get up to the front of the building here, you do see multiple guards. Kind of, it seems like everybody is awake, having been aware of some sort of event happening tonight. Are you all just heading in?
Yeah, I'll keep following Jackal.
Okay.
As we're walking, I want to look for like arrow slits in the walls or anything. Like, are we being led into an ambush? Are we being led to execution?
Yeah. So as you're walking in, there's actually no like arrow slits. They're full windows. Though they do seem to have steel bars on most of them. As you look, you do see one guy kind of looking out the window a little bit, but nothing, no weapon drawn. It's well lit. There's people coming and going, you know, armed guards. This is clearly some sort of outpost for the guards that post here in Ormskirk.
Got it.
But it looking at it, there's nothing hostile other than the extreme amount of guards with weapons. But they're not drawn. They're not looking to be offensive.
Okay.
So everybody walks in and you're led into a large hall first. Two massive tables running either side of it. On them, the occasional helmet or swords out just from guards getting ready or getting ready to move out. Multiple doors around it as the jackal walks straight down the center. Come now. As he just keeps walking forward. Captain Tarek comes into the building and he's cut off immediately to the right where he seems to be talking to a bunch of a small group. I shouldn't say a bunch, but three guards that he starts talking to. As the jackal, please now, Gaikon, we need to lock this one up for a very long time. As he heads off to a door in the very back of the room, which leads down a set of steps. A few moments later, everybody's following him down these stone steps. You come to a basement level. Stone-lined walls, iron bars on cell doors. As you walk through, most cells seem to be empty. There's one man passed out, it looks like, or sleeping, wearing rags, scraggly long hair, kind of unconscious or something, in one of the corners of the first cells. But past that, they seem to be mostly empty as he leads you to a cell in the very back. He pulls out a small set of keys, flips through a couple, unlocks it. As the door squeaks open, please, after you.
Am I alone?
No, everybody's here. The whole group. Unless everybody doesn't want to follow him down the stairs, but I assumed you stuck together.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, so it's just you up front with the rest standing kind of a few feet behind you. But
please. So I'm going to kind of sling him as best I can into the room without going into it as well.
Yeah, for sure. So you take a moment. You literally, with ease, with your strength, just kind of by his ankles, drag his head and flip him. As he hits the ground in the back, you see the jackal kind of, well done, thank you. As the door shuts, locks, pulls out the keys. Please now. Dinner, anyone?
Ona asking about when we're going to discuss pay.
I would gladly take food first.
Of course. We'll get to your pay. No worries. Please. Food first, and then we'll talk of business. Because I am famished.
I want to ask Jackal, Oh, now, boy,
you got any swamp crawlers up there, man? Well, I got you a good spicy swamp crawler right now. I swear to God, I swear.
Yes, as he just walks away.
You get used to him, the way he talks. I know it's strange, but...
It's honestly astonishing. I speak fluent Draconic. I have no idea what he's saying.
He's speaking common. I just sometimes can't quite catch all the words he's saying.
Honestly.
I just want to, like, hold my hands out and, like, shrug, like, what the fuck, man?
Daikon, are you frozen?
I am. I'm working on it.
I just see.
Hence the one.
Dude, he's fucking.
Yeah, that's the one moment.
He's gonna be the next Hokage.
Yeah, he's casting.
You're all good. I was just making sure I wasn't missing. I was like, is he waiting for something? What am I?
No, I'm taking a moment to try a different approach since the cam keeps dying. It's getting to the point. It's pissing me off.
No worries, brother.
Shot.
All of a sudden, there's
guess who's turning into Naruto after this?
Yeah. All of a sudden, there's a fucking poof of smoke, and there's six sexy guy cons.
Please no.
Please no. I'll go ahead and follow Jackal in. And immediately, when she sees the table, she's going to sit down and start stuffing her face with food.
Yeah. As you guys head back up the stone steps into this big, large hall, this dining hall of some kind or gathering place for the guards here. He holds a hand out, and the tables, which were mostly bare at this point, there's plates of bread, and we'll have some soup out shortly. As he walks to the opposite side of the table, sits, kind of lifts his rapier, places it up on the table. And at this point, for once, you get to see this rapier with the handguard spiraled in gold, small jewels inlet on it as he places it down.
Is there any kind of iconography of, like, a wealthy family or anything like that on it?
Make a history check.
I like the way you said that. 21.
So as you're looking over it, it feels familiar, but not having grown up in the Irglad or Itheltal or with that elven culture that you were so lacking. It feels familiar, maybe, but you're not sure.
But I get the sense that it's, like, gorgeously made.
I mean, it's clearly a step above any form of normal, like, weapon. And even then, something you'd see in, like, a royal household. This is probably something a little special.
Well
done. I'm, first of all, is everyone all right? How are you doing? Do I need to call any of our town clerics, or?
My throat's a bit sore, but I think I'll be all right.
You took it like a champ, though, honestly. You're still here. Well done.
I want to, like, hold my hand up the back of the neck and, like,
I know what now, boy. Got a little pin on back of the neck. Can't feel the left side of my body. I'll give you a little help over here. I'm a little beat up.
He looks over to you, Ruka. What did he say?
I just had my claw come out my nose.
He said that he's having a bit of pain in the left side of his body, and he would like some help.
Oh, of course. Sorry, again, the dialect. It's... beautiful sounding, but I have no idea what you're saying 90% of the time.
That's what I'm here for.
Yeah, we're slowly learning.
As he kind of holds a hand up, please, can I get the healing potion? I think that will suffice, correct? And he just nods his head at you before you answer. Yeah, a healing potion. And you see one of the guards that was at the front of the tables that was getting geared up. Oh, right away, sir! As he runs off into a side room.
Can I, like, show him my fucking neck? Like, trouble you for two while you're at it.
Ooh. Yes, of course. Hold on. As he reaches down in a little side satchel he has and he pulls out one. This is mine! Please, let's put it to good use. As he hands you a greater healing potion, Ruka.
Can I quickly minor illusion something while holding my arm and like all of a sudden like for one, I'm gonna reach my hand underneath my cloak and like cast a minor illusion of like a wound and then show it to him once I cast it and say, mind if I have one too?
Yeah, of course.
Notice.
He's so fucking cool.
So cool.
So as cool. You kind of do this and you try to mumble under your breath the incantation of the wound as you lift the sleeve and you see like a gash that's kind of bleeding. It's kind of gnarly looking. He kind of looks to you. Oh, well, that is troublesome. As he takes his sword out and the hilt of it, he just kind of taps you with it as it just fades away.
Okay, I lied.
I know.
All right, so while all this is going on, are we, we're back up in the main hall with the tables, right?
Yep, there's food being brought out. You have soup, there's ale. Definitely got ale ready for the dwarf. And some bread here, as everyone's just taking a moment to just...
I would like to pay some extra special attention to the captain and the three guards he's talking to, just to make sure that their intents are still friendly towards us.
Yeah, go ahead and roll perception for me. Okay. Actually, also, can I get a perception check from Clover?
16.
All right. So Clover, Gaikon, I'll get to you in a quick sec. Clover, just real quick, after when he held the sword by its sheath in the scabbard and it touched you, there was a moment where you saw one of the gems inlaid in the hilt kind of brighten, then dull completely. Like it lost its shine as he set it back down. Gaikon, as you sit and you watch the guards, you see the captain over there talking to three. Not once does he turn to face your table. But one of the guards kind of looks over and you see a familiar face, a little battered, a little bruised. Poor Mallory. One of the few that did not lose his life on the barge or get thrown over.
Would I know of a gem that could detect redeem magic?
Sorry, what was that, Gaikon? 2 seconds, Jess.
I'm sorry. That was me talking to Chad. Redeemed non-murder hobo.
Perfect. So, Clover, as you take a moment, make an Arcana check.
17.
You don't know of a particular gem, but you know that certain items can be infused with some sort of magics, like more powerful weapons and armors, wondrous items, if you will. And it seemed to have some sort of power in the sword that allowed him to dispel something.
Jackal.
Yes, dear.
The gem on your hilt there, I couldn't help but notice it. Did you enchant that?
Oh, myself? No. This, I call it precision, is a weapon, a tool, an instrument of my family has been passed down for a few generations. We've worked as inquisitors for some time. It has a few tricks up its sleeve, as you saw.
I have a pen pal that I write to that is from, I believe, the city where the elves come from.
Ithiltal.
Yes, Ithiltal.
Have you ever been?
No, I've wanted to go.
Magnificent. I haven't been home for some time, but magnificent. Make
I'm
a
gonna
trip
nod
there,
and
the
just
forests. If you could even call it that. Beautiful. But as for the rest of you, good work. Unfortunately, some of you fell, but here you are still. It shows some character. On that note, a potion is brought out to you, Broix. It's just a regular healing potion, but it's a 2d4 plus 4, I believe. We'll go with that. Ruka, yours was a greater, which I think is 44.
Plus... Correct.
Yeah, cool.
I'm going to put it in front of me. I'm not going to drink it. Just
okay. On to the important bit, though. Payment. Did good work. I'd recommend you be careful. On edge for the next while. Sariandi is no... is not someone to be underestimated or trifled with. She is an assassin of the eye, and on top of that... was trained in Ithoktal. She is troublesome. She is no mastermind or grand schemer like our friend below, but is not somebody you want upset with you.
And morphs genders from conversation to conversation.
Now that Voltal is taken out of the equation, who's going to replace him?
Honestly, I have no idea. Hopefully no one here. They shouldn't be here.
Do you think Sariandi might take it? She seemed quite respected.
Honestly, until I have more time to look into this, no, I do not know who or where she'll end up be or mantle she'll take up. She is still part of the Eye, and I'm sure at some point she'll be back in Sartul to... report.
In your investigation, did you ever find who Voltor answered to, the superior?
Yes. But that is not something for you to worry about just yet.
Well, I'm not worried about that. I'm just worried about who we just pissed off and who's going to be coming for our heads aside from the elf.
So, good bit of news. I don't believe anyone other than maybe the elf will be coming for your head. Voltar happened to be doing something a little on his own here. Maybe unsanctioned by the Eye. It seems he was branching out on his own to an extent.
What's to be the fate of Voltar?
Well, for now, he'll be interrogated. For some time, honestly. It's not going to be great for him. But, depends if he cooperates.
Could I make a suggestion?
Please.
Lay him on his left side, take a small hammer, and go after his liver first. He'll talk.
Oh, wonderful.
I don't like Voltor.
Clover's gonna look up with greasy fingers and a greasy mouth, and
oh yeah, just
she's gonna have food in her mouth. Ruka, why don't you tell them about Barca? Because Barca was the one that sent you.
I'm gonna walk over. I'm walking down to, and I'm using my fucking scarf, and I'm just gonna wipe her fucking face and go, not here, not here.
So payment. A slight smirk and laugh. So, well, one, the price on your heads has been lifted. I believe that should be the first order of business.
Thank you, Jackal.
Thank you, Jackal.
Thanks, Dad.
So cool. Cool dad. Cool
so
dad,
fucking
Jackal.
Cool.
We're not grounded anymore.
He's like your friend's dad who picked you up from school in a Corvette. You're just like, oh.
You're my dad.
A few friends of ours We're not thrilled, but money talks. And so do orders, and Tarek's a strong, good man, and he'll listen. He's honorable. He may not like you, but he'll not harm you or arrest you. As for some coin, it won't be much, but I have more work for you if you actually would like to earn some coin.
Well, let's discuss how much coin you're talking about now. That will probably have a big effect on how willing we are to continue working with you.
Of course. So, minus the 2,000 gold per head, that's 25 gold per person. As he takes out a coin purse, 100 here, and he places it on the table. Do with it what you will. Split it among who wants what. It's enough to earn a living for a good while and get some food and repair any armor damages. It's nothing to live off of. But then again, there's a few who aren't living off at all. So
it's only 25 gold total.
25 gold per person. It's 100 gold total.
Oh, okay. I'll go ahead and just get 20 gold just for myself and leave 5 for whoever wants to grab it.
I'm taking... Well, I'll let them pick through and I'll take what's left.
All right. I want to grab my 25 gold. And also I want to grab an extra... extra, like, mug of mead.
Yep.
To head towards Mallory.
Okay.
Quick sec. Okay.
No, sorry. Can you continue?
No. Just... gonna walk to him carefully, slowly, in a non-threatening manner.
As he kind of leans in a little closer to the three of you who are still here, Broek stands up. Living on the right side of law isn't always glorious or going to earn you a lot of coin, but it'll keep you out of trouble. And who knows? You make the right friends, you'll make some more money. Broex, as you have the ale, and you said you have your 25?
Yeah.
All right, you head up, and you start walking over towards the three guards. There's two you don't recognize, and Mallory, plus Tarek being the fourth one there talking.
Oh, jeez, there. Oh, fuck, okay. All right, yeah, continue. Full spin.
Full spin.
So, as you kind of walk over, you get within, like, 10 feet of him. Tarek kind of hears you, turns, looks over, and they all kind of stand, arms crossed. Mallory's there. His face is a little beat up. And you see him kind of scowl at you. It's not great looking, but the other two kind of, they've clearly heard of you. What do you want? As Tarek speaks up.
All right. I just want to just... ignore what Tarek says because he's just a salty bastard.
You kill some people.
Yeah.
You specifically.
Just two, all right? Calm down. I'll look towards Mallory and be like, I appreciate all the help now. You know, I'm sorry what I did to your friends. You know, I'm sorry you got hurt and whatnot. I bring this meat now over here, boy, for a peace offering. And there's 25 gold, you know, just. Use it how you cover any damages for you or help the family. That's all I'm saying. I just want to, you know, place the gold down on the table or whatever's next to them or fuck on the floor. There's not next to
them. So there's a table kind of on the corner right there.
Okay.
As you place it down in the ale.
Place the cup and the gold and just like kind of like give like a thumbs up like, you know, sorry about that. and thank him for the help. Yeah.
Okay. There's almost a moment where Mallory's looking at you like standoffish as he kind of looks to the captain.
What'd he say?
Looks to you. Thank you. He kind of yells it a little bit like, what language? As he kind of grabs the mug, again, looking up at the captain. The captain just kind of scowls at him and he starts to walk away. Grabs the coin. Steps back. Looks to his guard buddies. Cheers.
Bless he kind of
ties the little coin purse there and just smells the ale first. You know, like, looks in it.
Anyone that will help a stranger shit off the side of a boat is a good man in my book.
He's a good fucking dude. He's a good man.
I'm sorry, to be granted, he was ordered to.
Yeah.
There may have been a little bit of like the FNG, the fucking new guy on the boat, you know, he wasn't pleased, but it doesn't matter.
He's a good man.
He did it. As he kind of holds it up to you, drinks and kind of turns back to his buddies like, and you hear him kind of go, "What the fuck did he say?" And they both kind of go, I think he gave you the gold. I good dude. I don't know.
Do I notice this confusion as I'm walking up?
100%. 100%. You see, they literally think you're speaking a different language.
All right. I would turn to him and like slowly fucking, you know, pull out like the loot or something. You know, hands where I can see him type thing, because I ain't looking to get fucking clapped.
Okay, so with the you put the hand up and they both kind of look at you for a minute as they see it grab this ginormous fucking loot as it flips over your shoulder. And now they're like, okay.
And like, you know, kind of clear my throat and just...
It's cutting out really bad.
Oh, really?
Can't hear it at all.
Maybe whenever I start singing, I don't know.
Oh, yeah, let's give it a shot.
Yeah, give it fucking full send, dude.
For fuck's sake, he's singing again.
Eventually.
Sorry for what I did. Please take this mug of mead and all this gold. Please distribute it to all the families I might have hurt. I'm sorry, Mallory. I'm sorry, Mallory. Thanks for letting me shit off the side of a boat.
Two guards both look at him.
Thank you, Mallory.
Both of the other guards look at him. Look at you. Look at him. And he goes, "I don't want to talk about it." Thank you. As he kind of just turns and starts walking away. The other two are like, a little round of applause. Very, very light golf claps, but like, all right. He went for it. Full send.
The captain has walked the fuck.
Make a perception check.
Fuck yeah, he's so cool. Notice me, senpai. 18. Notice me, senpai.
I'm still watching the captain, right? Keeping an eye on him.
The captain, after talking to these guys and having Brooks walk up, the captain walked off into a back office that looks like he shut the door with like an audible slam, but he left the room. Right before the song started. So the captain didn't hear it. But the jackal, as you start to turn around and walk back with your loot, like, yeah, I just fucking did that all proud and shit. The jackal's got an eyebrow raised looking at you.
Oh, he noticed. I'm going to give him a thumbs up.
A single.
I'll take it. He's so cool. No one else got a clap. I got a clap. Eat shit, guys.
Well, unless there's anything else, I do have more work for you. I'd like to speak to our friend downstairs first. Tomorrow morning, meet here. I can get you rooms in a local tavern if you'd like. Or you are welcome to stay here, though not the best accommodations.
We'll take the inn. Thank you for your generosity.
Jackal, before you leave, I'm gonna keep 5 gold and give him 20.
Mm-hmm.
I tried making amends with Captain Tarek, but I imagine he's quite miffed. So can you see to it that this gold makes it to the families of the men that he lost, the men that we killed? I wish to do my best to make amends. And if there's any ability of amenity, that would be appreciated.
Our line of work is not one that is glamorous or one where we make many friends. We'll take care of it.
I've got... I look back at Clover and Gaikon and Bro, and I've got more friends now than I've ever had. And I just want us to be on the up and up with the gods. That's all.
Have no fear around here. The word did not travel past Ormskirk of your deeds, and I think at this point you'll be all right. Though, maybe be scarce around town for now. You'll of find course. No trouble, but you've also made no friends. Well, one friend.
See, Mallory's not looking.
As he kind of stands up and starts walking away.
Can I make an insight check to see if Jackal was... If that was his purpose, is Jackal our friend? Am I Jackal's friend?
Make an insight check.
Fuck yeah. It's a natural one. God damn it.
Fuck, who was he talking about? Shit! Was that it? Was that the moment? Was he talking about me? Was he talking about...
That's what's happening to me right now.
You're panicking, dude. Like, fuck. Was he... Am I the Jackal's friend? Did he...
Knees weak, arm spaghetti.
Wait, no. Is he talking about Mallory? Because they just sang Mallory a song. Is it Mallory the friend? What about the... Fuck! He just blew it.
As Jackal's walking away, can I just look at him and be like, wow, he's really cool, but say it out loud and see if he looks over back at me.
As he's walking away, there's almost like a pause in his step as he keeps walking. No turn, not, but he heard.
That's all I wanted.
I'm walking back to Clover and just like again, like gritting my teeth, and she's so goddamn cool.
As you watch him head back down the stairs where you came, you'll see a little paper left on the table that wasn't there before.
I'm going to pick it up and read it.
As you kind of lift up the paper and start scanning it. Broken sword in. Rooms paid for.
Two rooms?
Rooms. Doesn't say how many.
Broken sword.
I'm gonna find out when we get twist there. It into like a roll and shove it into my bag.
I'm going to go ahead and pick up my 25 gold and shove it into my pack.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, you got 25. Everything. So, sorry, how much did you take, Clover?
20.
So there's an extra 5 left on the table.
I'm going to look around at the rest of the group and motion towards the 5.
So I'll pick it up.
Everybody wants it.
All right, Ruka. Ruka grabs it. So, you pack up your belongings. You've had a hearty meal. You're all a little dinged up, or at least some of you are a little dinged up. Some of you are fucking fine, Bear. And you walk back out into the night. For a moment, there's that feeling of, we're not running. This is good.
We done did good.
Hey, real quick, as we like exit, can I shoot Mallory like a thumbs up as I'm leaving?
So your first, Clover, Gaikon, and Ruka all walk out, start heading for the door, and as you start packing up your stuff, there's almost like a little bit of a twang on your loot, and he gets his attention.
We lock eyes from across the room.
You give him that thumbs up and like that.
Seduce Mallory, scaly...
I just need everybody to picture real quick. You know that scene in Godzilla, the big when you see the eye and then it lifts its head and you see that big toothy fucking mouth? That's smiling right now. That's what's smiling at Mallory. He's like, gives you a nod.
As you head out with your friends. Now, Broix, you have heard of the Broken Sword Inn. You've been there once or so. It's not expensive, but you know.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta pay to stay there, so you don't stay there often. But you're able to lead the party if you would like so to. Or you can make them wander. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, I want to... So how much of this town do I know?
You know the rough layout of the entire town.
So I know basically all the good spots, you'd say.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, since the night is young, you know, high spirits and whatnot. I'm feeling good. And, you know, got a little bit of a bug going now, but we're going around town. I want to show you the town before we go to sleep.
Okay, I'd love to see the town. I think that's what you said.
And so as we pass like storefronts and
so most of the stores at this point are definitely closed, but the taverns and inns would be open.
Like, point out the good spots. So like I want to point out like I guess med, like almost like doctor office type stuff.
Yeah. So armors, as you kind of walk around, there's an armory that you know, a blacksmith armor. There's a town square where most of the stalls where you see a lot of those pop-up traders and fruits, most of those are packed up at this point. And as you kind of continue through the center of town heading towards the general direction of the Broken Sword, you know, there's a small temple to Pelor or Diasolus. There is an apothecary, just a general trader where you can grab your normal items you might need. Other than those specific callouts, there's not like any grand shops, if you will, in Ormskirk.
Question. There's a point I just read. Are we still covered in blood?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I was going to say, I still have bleeding wounds.
How close?
So there's no bleeding at the. And so you have wounds, but for the most part, they don't continue to bleed, if you will. Like you're able bodied and smart enough to realize, I don't want to die. So you would do that. That's why your armor, your tabards are shredded. You are covered in your own blood and blood of an orc and dwarf and your friends, but you are not continuously bleeding though.
How close to the river are we?
Oh, Ormskirk is on the river. There's a small bridge. Okay. There's multiple mills that run on the water, making grain from the fields and such.
Okay, I'm gonna make the suggestion that, oh, you know, it's not gonna look good when, you know, someone look out the window and they see four guys, especially a big ass fucking dragon covered in blood, and they're not gonna look good. They're calling the guards and they need to know, but down there with Voltor himself. Well, I think we can go down there, watch up a little bit, and then, you know, get a little bit presentable.
That's a good idea.
What did he say, Ruka?
I want to just grab Plover like by like the back of the collar. How close to the water are we?
I mean, it'd take you a minute to walk there. Okay. It's not far.
Never mind. I want to set her back.
Excuse me.
He said it would probably be a good idea for us to wash off instead of prancing around in blood, lest we wind up next to old Vol. I think he's right.
Speaking of blood, did you guys see how far Gaikon chucked that orc's head when he chopped it off?
That was bloody impressive.
I'm trying to take it for a souvenir, but no, Captain Fucker Wet Blanket over there wouldn't let me take a single damn thing.
You got the maul. You were able to, you already had the maul in hand, so you have that.
Oh, wait, so I got,
You got the big ass hammer. Yeah, it's just fucking bloody looking hammer.
I'll turn towards Gaikon. I want to present to him, like, give him like a little thumbs up.
Very nice, Brox. Very nice. Can you swing that?
I look at him like, you know, my hands, they're a little more complicated than the finer craft. I could swing it, but you've shown you can do a lot better than that. You'd.
Are you offering this to me?
Dick.
I want to like kind of like just kind of like drop it in his.
Gaikon, if you refresh your D&D Beyond, I already gave you one.
Oh, I see.
It is, so instead of a 1d12, it's 2d6. So, you know, no matter what, you're going to roll technically higher, but at the same time, it's not a singular d12.
Fucking canoe some chests.
You equipped it as well. Yeah.
I did. Totem of the Bear.
Perfect. All right, so you're not a berserker. So it doesn't... For one of a barbarian's later abilities is called Brutal Critical, where you get to roll an extra damage die of whatever type it is. So great axes are best for it, honestly, because you get to roll multiple d12s. That's good. Versus rolling one more d6. You don't get to roll multiple more d6. So right now, it's up to you. Whatever, it's really flavor. They're comparable. In the future, it's probably better looking for something with a big damage die, a d10 or a d12. But right now, it doesn't matter. It's up to you.
I'm gonna go ahead and stick with my great axe. I'm gonna just go ahead and.
You got it. You got the maul just in case you lose
right
the
over
axe.
My shoulder.
Perfect. So as you you all take a moment to
throw that axe down the road.
Walk down the river. Walk down to the river, and there's a sandy shore in one spot you're able to find. You take the next 15-20 minutes to get the blood out. It's particularly on you, bro, and Ruka. Gaikon, you got mostly other people's blood all over you.
I was gonna say, I mean, there's my blood, there's the orc's blood, there's the other dwarf's blood, there's Ruka's blood.
Yeah, you're you look, yeah, you took a bath. Ruka's got it real bad, bro. Not as bad because it was just a singular arrow and it never got, like, you know, throat. But, yeah.
I want to motion towards Clover. I'd be like, did I get it all on my back, little girl? Like, I can't see back there. Like, I keep reaching. I don't know if there's no blood back.
I'm going to peek and see how much blood there is.
Oh, the back of his neck is a fucking mess. It's disgusting.
Oh, can you sit down? I'll try and get it for you.
All right. I just want to plop down in the water.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like a murder scene, but then again.
I'm gonna
like dark, thick black, just dried all over the, like, it's this tabard, like that nice brighter, that nice bright color, just stained all the way down your back. Yeah.
I'm gonna fill up my water skin, and I'm gonna just go back and forth pouring the water on his neck to try and get the water off.
Yeah, like I said, over the next 15 minutes, you're able to mostly clean yourselves up. Clover, you're honestly fine and mostly helping everybody scrub the blood from all of their bodies. Ruka, Gaikon, bro, all covered. So, but yeah, 15-20 minutes, you're able to clean yourselves. You're all damp and wet at this point, but the inn's not far.
Yeah. Yes, I'm gonna lead them to the inn.
All right, yeah, you head back up the bank. You continue through town. You pass through that giant town square, the opposite side of it, as you wrap around one of the side roads. And there you see another fairly large building, three stories, though not very wide. It seems somewhat tall. One of the tallest buildings in town, honestly. As you come up to the main steps, you see a sign hanging from it. And though there's no name that says Broken Sword, you see the hilt of a sword. The sword came out and it shattered with pieces around it. And most know it. Bro, you know this as the Broken Sword.
Look towards them. I'm a nod. I'm like, oh, did the place now.
Does it look nicer from the one that we were in before?
Oh, much, much nicer.
I'm going to go ahead and open the door and walk in and take a look around, see what I...
Yeah, you walk
in there and everything.
I wanted to be the last to enter. As Gaikon passes me, I just want to look at him and just try not to break the chair this time. What are they really not?
Okay, as you all kind of take a moment and walk in, bro at the back, you walk in to a bustling tavern. Lots of people in here right now. It's honestly a nice, refreshing mood compared to what you've been dealing with. And There's the sounds of music being played. There's patrons laughing, mugs of ale being thrown back. The main bartender just kind of slinging porn drinks, laughing. A big balding man, a patchy kind of beard. And seems like a good time. As you walk in, bro, there's... Oh, sorry, no, he doesn't have a beard. He has a big mustache. And as he kind of looks over, "Hey, Broix, how you doing?" And you recognize him. You have seen him before because you've played here a few times. His name's Tristan Morningfall.
I'm gonna look towards him. Getting like facial recognition on him, what exactly is our history? Is it just solely just playing?
Yeah, you coming into the tavern and playing for patrons, getting you haven't been kicked the fuck out per se, but you know, you've drank a little bit too much once or twice, but not bad, you know.
Okay.
You've been through here. It's hard to forget a giant dragonborn bard. You know what I mean?
I will look. You said Tristan, right?
Tristan, yes.
Yeah, I'll look to him. I'm like, "Tristan, goddamn ball, good to see you." I'm fucking just like push Clover and Godcon to the side. I was like fucking like hobble over there, still damp, so you get like the kind of little.
Oh yeah, like you're soaking wet. Like, yeah. Sloppy feet, 100%. As you walk over,
shake his hand.
"Hey lad, what the fuck have you been up to?" As he goes to shake your hand, you see you're dripping. He's like, "I mean, on my floors. You got coin?"
"No, I got coin. I got coin. What are you talking
Then you got about? Ale." As he turns back and starts filling some mugs, puts them on the tables. "You got your friend there with you. Nice. And who are these two?"
We little girl, little tiny thing. You could turn into a bear. I'll tell you about that later.
A bear.
It works too tight, buddy.
What?
Oh, I can show you.
There I was, walking like in and out of
consciousness. Not in here.
I'll tell you about that later, but like. And then the short little one, you go by Gaga, like.
I remember the dwarf. Starts with a G. What's his name again?
Gaikon.
I'm gonna belt out Gaikon.
"Hey, Gaikon! Hey, nice seeing you again, man."
Then the big old tar drink of water over there. That's
Ruka. Hey. Well, don't cause any trouble. He's a shit, but if he's buying your drinks, he's a good shit.
I also want to like lean in towards him and like, "Listen, we're a little damn little cold. You got any bone broth or
just something warm to inside?"
"Hey, I'll get you a table over near one of the hearths there. It'll warm you right up. Room's the normal."
I want to motion for Clover to bring over the note from fuck, he's so cool.
Jackal,
thank you. Sorry.
Okay, I'll walk over and hand Tristan the note myself. And tell
how'd you got here last? Actually... As he pulls it up, kind of opens it. You're working with the guard now.
Long story short, boy, we got in a little bit of trouble. Got a little bit of boo-boos. Made a little bit of gold. Listen, long story short,
I don't care. Tell me no more. I heard gold. We're good. As he kind of rolls the parchment up. "You got two rooms upstairs. I'll get you the keys." As he kind of walks off behind, comes back, four mugs, places them on the table. You know the price. As he turns back around, grabs something under the counter, comes back. "Keys, here you go. Upstairs, second floor."
What exactly is the price from me remembering?
From that, it's probably usually a silver or so for ale.
I want to slip him one gold, be like, "You know, good to see you, boy. You know, you treat me good every time I come."
"Yeah, you got a couple rounds for that tonight." And he takes it, kind of puts it in his pocket.
I want to get a big old...
Sorry, I'm losing. I'm dying.
Grab my mug and turn towards Guy, kind of hold up, like, "Hey, no, boy, we got it."
I'm Clover is actually for the first time going to start sipping on the ale.
Oh, it's warm and it's delicious. As one of the where is it? One of the waitresses that works here runs Tristan's daughter. Seems to bring you guys. Well, over here, please. As she hurries you off out of the middle of the doorway, right in the front of the bar, to a table that's right next to a big fireplace, though. Cat just crackling fire. It's honestly great because you're all wet.
Mm-hmm. Betty, real quick, do I notice anything like out of the ordinary in the bar?
So it is a fairly normal tavern, I guess. Hold on, let me grab it real quick.
What kind of lifestyle is this place offering? Is it like modest? Is it comfortable? Is it wealthy?
I mean, there's nothing wealthy really in Ormskirk. That's probably the most important thing to take away from it. I just lost the tavern though. So it is multiple. It's fairly tall. It's not cramped feeling in here. Long beams, candles all around it. It's well lit. Music playing on a slightly elevated stage in the corner next to one of the hearths. There's two of them. One near on your side of the building and one on the opposite side. So it's like a throat.
As Tristan's daughter puts a mug down in front of me and Ruka looks up and thank you, love. I got Tristan's name. What's yours?
Liza.
I'll grab Liza. That broth for you as she
hurries off. One moment. We've been on the road for quite some time. You can probably tell. Do any of these lads fancy game of cards or dice or some sort of game?
I mean,
I think sleep is probably in our best.
Ask is plenty here. I don't see any cards out now or dice, but that's not to say somebody's not up for a game.
Fair enough. Thank you.
As she hurries off, you see her kind of head back into the kitchen somewhere where you're probably gonna end up with food shortly. Like I said, the inn itself is, it feels like kind of a happy, jovial environment. It's very warm in here. The smells of food are rampant. Like, definitely some sort of spice and meats going. It's, as Broix knows, good inn. It's by no means expensive or fancy, but is a good inn. Multiple races, couple dwarves, couple humans, a halfling in the corner. It's fairly busy. After you guys are sat, you have your drinks. A few moments later, four bowls of a warm broth are all brought out and placed around the table.
Batty, question. Last time I seen Tristan, this is his daughter, correct?
Yes.
How old would she have been?
I believe late 20s, early 20s, 20s.
Okay. Alright, I want to slip her...
You know, the tavern's owned and run by Tristan, his wife Muriel, and their daughter Eliza. They have another young lad that helps and runs tables as well.
Gotcha. I want to slip her like 5 silver. And be like, this one for you. Keep it away from the old man.
You're wonderful. You're too kind. Thank you! And she kind of whispers away, dancing off to the side of the room.
Typical bard.
Could have been a lot worse, bud.
No complaints.
No,
here.
It wouldn't have.
Make all the friends.
Friends.
Can I make an insight check just to see, like, is Brobard really, or is Brorux really, like, charming with women, or do they just think he's cute because they can't understand? Like, what?
Roll
what
an insight check.
As I wink across the table towards Getty.
12.
He seems, at least in this place, compared to how we act with guards, it's like almost a complete flip in personality. He has a very positive demeanor here. and honestly, at least here, he doesn't seem to be hated. They know who he is and what he is, and he's treated as such.
Fair. Guy Kong, while we're here and we have a moment, we've seen what bro can do with his loot and with his fucking words, apparently. Clover can turn into a bear. I know, I just said that out loud. It's kind of strange. But, Gaikon, where did you get the bear skin and, you know, the axe from?
I don't have a bear skin. Talking about the owl bear head?
Correct.
It's an owl bear, yeah.
Yeah, owl bear.
Me and my friend that I grew up with slayed it in the woods northwest of here, near the mountains.
That's just where you came from, northwest from the mountains. No family.
Oh, I have a family, but they wouldn't have me. So, I found this bear. It's a young cub. And we just pretty much looked out for each other and took care of each other. Till some hunters killed her one day. And I set off after these hunters, and when I learned that I could rage, I've pretty much just been doing my own thing ever since, until I found myself in a trap I couldn't get out of. About the time I completely gave up is when Rorix came around and saved me from that trap.
Mouthful of soup, I want to turn towards them and be like, oh, I remember that. That was quite the whopper we gave that group of people now.
Taking notes, one second. I mean, that certainly explains a lot about your relationship with Bro. Because you mentioned several times that he saved your life, but you never mentioned it was from a trap.
Some massive trap. I can't even imagine what foul beast it was made for.
Is he talking about a bear trap?
He genuinely
doesn't
know.
Much larger.
I'll never tell.
Okay. Well, I'm fucking exhausted. Who fancies a game of dice? And I pull my dice out, put them on the table.
Oh, I love playing dice with you, Ruka, and she kind of slurs her words.
Have you been fucking drinking?
And she has like a third drunk already. I only had a little bit.
Clover, you clever shit. When did you start drinking? And now Ruka's gonna pick up a...
I just wanted to try it. It smelled really good just now. This is the first time I've had it. You know, it's not that good.
Try putting honey in it.
I'm gonna look around for some honey.
You don't see any on the tables.
Bro, can you get Clover some honey?
I'm just gonna nod towards him, you know, just creep up and then just,
you throw your hand up and towards the front. A small, much younger, probably somewhere in his early teens, young lad. So, hey, what can I do for you?
You got a honey back there, boy. Like, your little lady, she could use a honey and a drink or whatnot. You make it a little bit more palatable. Not saying the drink is bad and all. I'm just saying
Completely. He kind of looks over. I hate the smell too. It's not great, but let me grab you some honey. As he seems completely understanding every word you're saying. Perfectly.
I want to flick him 5 silver as well.
Don't tell the old man.
He kind of holds it. He's like, I'll do whatever you want. He kind of turns and walks away. Stares into your eyes. It's like, ugh. A little upsetting as he walks out back, comes back with a small like saucer, and it's got some honey. And he's, here you go. Kind of hands it over to you, Clover.
She uses quite a bit of it and just pours it in the drink and then drinks a little bit. Oh, yeah, that's much better. She starts chugging it.
Bro, question.
I know what up.
How much fucking time did you spend here for this child to be able to understand you? It's taken us 3 days.
I
You've only had a couple conversations with you with the kid. Like, it's surprising for even for you sometimes that he's.
To say I've been traveling with him forever and I still don't understand him.
I don't get it now, people. Now I'm just speaking the damn language as you. You don't seem to understand. I'm beginning to think there's something wrong with you folk now.
I'm gonna go with what I think I heard. I don't think there's anything wrong with us, so to speak. And there's nothing wrong with the way you speak. It's just different. It takes time for us to understand it, right?
And just not on me. I dig a sale.
Fuck. Over the next hour and a half, your food comes and goes. Drinks aplenty before you feel that weight of, what a day. What a fucking day. And y'all. I mean,
at this point, it's starting to get close to morning, right?
No, because you went out at your shit. That whole fight happened right at dusk. So it was, you know, 9. At this point, it's getting closer to like 1 a.m., though. After you were only in the barracks for a short time, and you've been here for a few hours drinking and reveling.
So, we ate there. We ate here as well.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, if you're drinking, you're eating.
I'm thinking I've got a full belly, and I'm ready for some sleep.
Right.
And none of that taking guard nonsense tonight. I'm getting a good rest.
And for the first time in a few days, you have that sense of, not necessarily security, but that sense of, I don't need to look over my shoulder. I'm not being hunted. You're in a fun, happy, warm place.
Got friends that run the inn. We've got guards that are looking out for us. I think a long rest is in store for us.
That sounds fair. Cursory glance, just scanning the heads of people around.
Yeah.
Do I happen to recognize? Fuck me, where'd I put it?
I'm gonna see him looking around, and I'm just gonna look around as well and scan the room for
Suryandi.
Abnormal.
So, give me a perception check from both of you two.
13.
2.
So, Gigon,
I'm sorry. Excuse me. I'm inspired.
You are. That's gone. Only lasts a minute.
Fuck.
Only lasts a minute.
Damn it.
So, Gaikon, having drank many a cup, as a dwarf does, you kind of do counting? A scan. Now we good. You got your axe. You got a maul now. You don't give a fuck. As you stand up, ready to head upstairs, bro, Clover as well. Ruka, you take a moment to scan the room. Looking for a particular elf. Though you don't see one, you do catch the occasional person look towards Broix, but it doesn't look hostile, more out of curiosity, honestly.
Used to it.
Just wanting to know what the hell he's saying.
When Clover does go up to the room, she's going to be stumbling and using her staff to support herself.
Without all the way up. Doubt. Give me a straight dex roll right now. Just roll plus your dex.
It's a nat 1.
Well, she dies.
So dead. As she...
She's going to fall down the stairs.
She takes the first step. Wah! Face on the fucking... She's out. Passed out. Done. Right then.
I'm just going to scoop her up by her belt and carry her up to one of the rooms.
I'll pick up her staff and follow and kind of guide Gaikon.
Yeah, as you guys head upstairs, there are two rooms right next to each other. Whoever is going where.
Did she happen to drop anything when she fell? Like anything out of her pack or anything?
No.
Cool, good.
Batty, is there any way I'd notice that person eyeballing me across the room?
No. Well, you know what? I would say this. It's not unusual for you to be eyeballed. Not necessarily in a hostile way, though. It's just a fucking dragon right there.
It's part of your fame.
Wow.
Happens, you know?
Holy moly.
All right. As everybody heads upstairs, they find their rooms. I'm assuming Ruka and Clover, Gaikon and Broix take the four beds available to them. The doors shut. The doors lock as you have keys.
Still shoving my axe under the door.
Fuck yeah, you do.
I'm taking one of my daggers and putting it in the jamb of the door to where if the door opens inward, it'll knock the dagger.
Of course. So you take some precautions, still being safe, but...
Is there any windows in the room?
Yeah, each room has a window. Again, you're on the second floor. There's no roof landing. It's a straight drop.
Question, what kind of window is it?
One of glass.
Does it open in any way?
It does.
How does it open?
It's like a singular swing. It doesn't open fully, but enough where you could, like, it'd be tough for you to get out, but you could probably do it.
Any sort of locking mechanism as well as curtains?
Curtains, yes. No lock.
Okay. Piss.
Two beds?
Two beds per room, yes.
Okay.
Have two rooms, so.
Gaikon and I are going to lay Clover in a bed, put her on her side, put a pillow behind her. You know, the whole drunk chick thing.
Yep.
And then I'm going to take the mattress off of my bed and use that to block the window, and I'll sleep on the floor.
All right.
I think I want to.
I'm going to look at Boris, shake my head, and say, there's no way I'm giving my mattress up.
Yeah. I want to. He took the words out of my fucking mouth. Prop that up, give some sort of security from the window. And you know, I'm fucking used to sleeping in the goddamn grass or on dirt. So, like, I'll sleep on the floor.
All right. Windows blocked, doors trapped and locked. You all settle in, some on beds, some on the floor. As you find sleep, finally.
I'd like to make one note real quick. The side of Clover's bed that I'm sleeping on is not the side that she's facing in case she throws up.
Smart
just
man.
Just putting that out there.
Yep. As sleep finds you all, it's a few moments, but you're not sure how long it is. Rest, you all are getting the benefits of a full long rest. Take your healing, do all those wonderful things. When Ruka. There's a moment where the dagger drops. You awake. And that's where we're gonna end tonight.
Motherfucker.
I knew it was coming. Fuck you, baddie.
That's why you always shove daggers in your doors.
Yep, it's true. Honestly, it's true.
Which reminds me, I'm down to my last one. Like, that's my last dagger, so I'm gonna have to go buy another one.
Well, I mean, you can pick up. Oh, yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah. I got you. Yeah, guys, there we go. Welcome from to the end. Of session 4, Disadvantage, our 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons game in my homebrew world of Icera. We have Golden Icon playing Gaikon, the Mountain Dwarf Barbarian. Jazzy Wazzy 94 playing Clover, our Forest Gnome Druid. Go Boba Fett playing Broix, our Bronze Dragonborn Bard. And of course, Gaddy playing Ruka DeLance, our... half elven rogue. And of course, me, I'm your DM baddie.
And now Wonderwall.
Because maybe. All
right, shut up. We'll be playing again next Saturday, or if you're watching this on YouTube, a Saturday, we're always here. 9 p.m. Eastern. Thank you, everyone. Please give everybody a follow that you see. You should see all their socials in here. Please do that. They're all okay.
You're okay too.
I mean, at best. So thank you again, and I'm gonna kill the recording. Goodbye.